Hey, James.
What's up, Tim?
Both of the movies we watched for the podcast today, The Core and Sunshine, they involve a team of scientists traveling to either the Earth's core or the core of the sun to detonate a nuclear bomb in the hopes of getting them working again. Is that what my trainer means when he tells me to work better on engaging my core?
Tim, I think you're being super critical.
Welcome to another episode of the Supercritical Podcast, where we delve into the fun and oftentimes nonsensical way pop culture portrays nuclear weapons. My name is Tim Westmyer, someone who studies nuclear weapons and works on nuclear nonproliferation for a living. And I'm joined today in the podcast studio over Zoom with returning special guest James Sheehan, a recovering transatlantic and terrorism policy practitioner turned tabletop gaming professional. You know what? Actually, no, scratch that. James, you're not so special anymore, at least not in the guest sense. James will be joining me moving forward as my regular co-host for the podcast. Welcome back and welcome as co-host.
Thanks, Tim. I'm very excited to be joining as co-host. You've kindly invited me and I've kindly accepted the invitation. I am a huge fan of the podcast. It was great to be on to discuss the Star Trek Smart Bomb episode last year. So this is great. And you've invited me on and now I'm just on. So I'm you know, it's like I'm like a vampire. Once I've been invited inside, I can enter whenever I like.
Yeah, you have the Zoom link. I can't be bothered to change it.
I'm thrilled to be on today and for future shows. This is Sunshine is you know, a film we've talked about before. I've told you my feelings about it, not to spoil what we'll discuss later, but I couldn't think of a better way to become acquainted as a host with the podcast. And The Core, you encouraged me to watch it last year. I did. Mm-hmm. And then rewatching it this week for the podcast was a lot of fun. So these are two great titles, and hopefully many more to come after this. This is a great way to come on board. So thanks a lot.
Well, no worries. Well, if people are listening, wondering where Gabe is, you know, don't worry about it. He's not like in a fallout shelter somewhere or flying his plane lost over the Bermuda Triangle. He just had a baby. So congrats to him. Certainly that makes things tricky to schedule these past couple of months since we haven't done an episode in a little while. So he's going to retire from regular hosting duties. We will definitely have him on again at some point in the year as a guest. And this is also an interesting reflection point for me. Sorry, before we get into the full parts of the episode. I've been doing the show since 2016. It was always my goal. I thought it would be cool if I can get to 100 episodes. So this is episode 71 of the quote-unquote normal episodes. And I also did 12 mini-nuke episodes, which were kind of a dumb idea because they were tended to be also as long as a regular episode because we just ramble. But if I did the math on that right, I've got about at least 17 left to do. So that's the target before I can retire. I may have, or at least keep the maybe going at a less regular pace. But we'll see. I think I got 17 good stuff to talk about. James has got a bunch of great ideas. So we'll see. We're going to hit 100, and then we'll see where we're at. I'm really excited to have you as this portion of the stage of the podcast history, because you've got, James, your own kind of movie-related goals for the year. You want to tell us a little bit about these pretty ambitious targets?
I would love to. So back at the beginning of the year, I decided, you know what, I'm over TV. There's a lot of great series out there. I've watched a lot of great series. You've discussed some great series on this program, but I'm like, you know what, movies. 2 hours, 3 hours. In the case of the one you and I saw last Thursday, this around this time, 4 hours.
Yep.
We saw The Return of the King remastered for theatrical release in the extended edition. So that's a long one, but I was like, I'm all in movies 2023. So yeah, so I had this, I think, unreasonable goal of watching 600 movies in 2023 and collecting 400 Blu-rays, because I love physical media. I've always loved like CDs and records and DVDs and stuff. And I'm like, you know what? I want the stuff, because sometimes, you know, they take it off services and you can't find it. And then sometimes, well, a lot of things you can't even, like, for example, the movie Airheads, you literally can't watch that movie anywhere right now. So I'm afraid of that. I'm afraid of the stuff disappearing or not subscribing to a service or disappearing from a service. So anyway, 600 films screened, 400 Blu-rays collected. So my wife correctly informed me that perhaps this was overreaching. And that, you know, I'm having a kind of a lighter stretch in my professional life at the moment. That's going to change soon. But even so, that's, you know, over, you know, two films a day is a lot. Even if sometimes you're not watching them, you're just watching one. So anyway, so as of today, I own 318 movies across 299 Blu-ray discs and 4K discs. And I basically have everything I want to own at this point, picking up little things as I see them in shops or online. Today, I watched Sunshine in preparation for this podcast, rewatched it, and that was my 151st feature film in 110 days of 2023. So if I keep to that pace, I'll hit 500 for the year. I'm not going to. I have a new job starting next week, so my time is going to be a little more of a premium. But I hope to maybe, I think I could still hit like the 300 mark or 350, maybe 400 watched. I even watched another one today. I watched Sunshine by Danny Boyle, and then I watched Trainspotting by Danny Boyle right after it. So I've seen 152 for the year, Sunshine being my 151st. So yeah, so that's the goal. So that's what qualifies me to be on the podcast, basically.
Excellent. Well, definitely the ratio in that number of both owned and watched in terms of nuke movies is definitely going to tick up quite a bit.
I think so.
I'm excited to help you with that particular ratio because I felt really it was off.
Yeah.
To help James get to this very ambitious goal, we are going to do a double whammy episode, as James kind of started at the beginning here. We're going to talk about two films where nuclear weapons are called upon to save the Earth from some sort of horrible natural disaster, but those nukes need to be first brought to different places other than the Earth's surface, where they tend to mostly be bad for people. First one of these movies we're going to talk about is The Core from 2003. This is where Earth's molten core has stopped spinning, and apparently that's bad. So they dig a hole and nuke it into spinning again. And then we're going to talk about Sunshine from 2007, where the Earth's sun has stopped being hot. And apparently this is also bad. So we're going to fly there in a spaceship and nuke it into being hot again. I think thematically, these are kind of fun movies to think about. We have some reveals here and there after watching them back to back. This is somewhat similar to an episode I did several years ago with my friend Boris, where we covered three movies that dealt with nuclear weapons being used against rocks in space, such as Armageddon, Deep Impact, and Meteor. So this is great. This is a good way to package these together. James and I are going to talk briefly about each movie's backstory, and then we'll get into the plot. James will cover Sunshine while I'll walk through The Core. And while we do this, and kind of near the end, we're going to have essentially two questions I think will be interesting to cover. The first of which is, how do these movies, along with others in this quote-unquote nukes good to save the Earth genre, what is the line that sometimes these movies have to walk where they recognize that nuclear weapons are dangerous, they're lethal to humans, they're maybe not the best thing, but in this situation, they're great, and they're feel like a hero kind of role. How do they make that balance if they try to? And secondly, how useful would these weapons actually be in either of these world-ending scenarios? James, anything else you want to preview for everybody as we get into this?
No, I think those are great discussion questions. I also have some takes that I'm excited to share in the parking lot portion of this episode. And so I won't spoil anything now. I think we'll come to all through the discussion, but I'm excited to dive in and run through the plots for our listeners and then head into the parking lot.
Sounds great. Well, let's dig in and we'll start with The Core. So as a reminder, as we go through the plot of these movies, spoiler warning, if you have not seen these films from the 2000s, they're available in different places. I think Sunshine is available for streaming in a couple different locations right now for free. I had to buy The Core again, 4K, because I couldn't find my DVD copy I bought several years ago. So now I can really watch that movie perfectly.
And a note on the Sunshine Blu-ray, it's sort of infamously known as one of the worst produced Blu-rays of all time.
Ooh.
When they released it, there's no way to watch it without also, I think, playing the director's commentary. Like, it's a broken disc.
Oh, wow.
They were all broken. In, like, whenever it came out, 2008 or something. Like, it came out in 2007, but then whenever the Blu-ray came out, maybe a year later, they allowed people to send them back, and they would send you a replacement disc. You could no longer do that. I had actually not watched this film on the Blu-ray cup I own until today, so I didn't know whether I had one of the cursed discs, because I bought it secondhand on eBay, or whether...
And what was it? What was it?
It worked. So I've got a proper disc. I don't have one of the broken discs. But I like this movie, so I own it in another format as well. So I had a backup, but
nice.
Well, just a little formatting side note there for listeners. If you're gonna buy a Sunshine Blu-ray, figures, you know, you're rolling the dice.
Yeah, either you got to make sure you like Danny Boyle's British accent, right? So The Core was directed by John Emil. I think it's his last name. The only other movie I really know him from is Entrapment, that movie that you're aware of with the crazy laser scene. And I think it's Catherine Zeta-Jones. This movie was made with a budget of $85 million in early 2000s, quite a bit. It made $74 million in the global box office, so not particularly great. This one has a pretty low Rotten Tomatoes critic score of 40%. Rotten, but Roger Ebert loved it. I think he gave it 2.5 out of 4 stars and said, I don't know how, but for some reason I love it. And like said, he was hard to convince people to not go see this movie, even despite the fact that it's very silly. All right, so we'll get into the plot here for The Core.
It was a secret government program known as Project Destiny.
We're building a weapon that could generate targeted seismic events.
Designed to use earthquakes to attack our enemies.
I'm getting a seismic reading.
It was a perfect, untraceable weapon.
Destiny is a go.
Until something went wrong.
I'll put this as simply as I can. Everybody on Earth is dead in a year.
The core of the Earth has stopped spinning.
The spinning core protects us from cosmic radiation.
Without it, radiation will create superstorms. Microwaves will literally cook our planet.
How could this have happened?
It was Project Destiny. We killed the planet.
So, how do we fix it?
We can't.
The core is the size of Mars. You're talking about jump-starting a planet.
What if we could?
We're here about your legendary ship.
I can't wait to get into an untested ship, go to the center of the Earth, and restart its core with 1,000 megatons of nuclear weapons.
Then we outrun the biggest shockwave in history.
Hot damn.
San Francisco is in ruins.
The whole West Coast is out.
And it's decaying faster than we thought.
2, 1.
We're going in.
Whoever goes into the core is not coming back.
We start off on Earth Day in Boston. And, oh, this is actually really good timing because Earth Day is Saturday, right? Here.
There you go.
Where when we're recording this, so perfect timing. I definitely planned this. So this takes place in Boston, and there's chaos in the streets. Random people are passing out for no real reason. There's car crashes. They're disrupting business meetings. How dare they? What's going on? Fortunately, though, back at this university, this character named Josh Keyes, played by Aaron Eckhart, has one of the best chins in Hollywood. He is a college geophysics professor, and he's teaching everybody about, you know, sound waves and the Earth's crust and all of this. And he gets brought in by the FBI and military people to talk about what just happened. All of these people dying kind of out of nowhere. This military guy led by Richard Jenkins, another great character actor, more than character actor, but he represents the military trying to figure out what's going on here.
Yeah, and this is one of those scenes where I'm actually upset that they cut off his lecture. I actually want to see what he's talking about. He plays the college professor really well. What he's doing with the sound waves is actually kind of fascinating.
Sure.
And they cut him off at like a really interesting point. Second time I watch this movie, I'm like, well, show me the experiment. I want to see what happens.
So I'm not a geophysics expert or anything, but the articles that I was reading about the science behind this movie, like we'll talk about it when we get later into these topics, but they were saying that this was complete absolute nonsense that he was talking about. But
that's probably why it's so compelling.
But that's why he's an actor. That's why he's an actor. Aaron Eckhart's Josh Keyes gets brought into this room, and he meets one of his like French scientist buddies named Serge, and they notice all of a sudden they're in a room full of 32 bodies, people who had died during the situation. And Aaron Eckhart pretty quickly realizes all of these people had pacemakers. Something messed with them, like an EMP, an electromagnetic pulse thing. And the military is wondering, is this a weapon? Could this have been something that someone attacked us with? Aaron Eckhart was like, nope, not possible, no way. And then they're like, fine, great. Never mind then, see ya. And they just don't care anymore, because if it's not a weapon, for some reason they don't really want to get to the bottom of why this happened. I'm not going to get into the nitpick every time the science in this movie is off, but you can have a pacemaker, it could fail, you're fine. Depends how bad your heart is. Pacemakers help keep your heart in a rhythm, but they don't, like,
right.
It's not like Tony Stark Iron Man. It's not like a thing that keeps you alive in that way, but nevertheless. But Aaron Eckhart still wants to figure this out because other weird stuff is happening in London. Thousands of birds freak out and start flying into people's cars and buildings. This is happening in Japan and everywhere else. Eckhart's figured it out. He figured it out that it's something having to do with the Earth's magnetic field, and he's willing to commit academic fraud in order to find out, meaning he says he's going to pass all of his doctoral candidates without even reviewing their dissertation. So this is the character that we got as our hero.
And he's going to exploit free labor from other PhD or master students to, like, he's like, yeah, pull out all the smart kids from this class, all the smart kids from this class. And it's like, buddy, come on, you know.
Yeah. But, you know, I guess it's for a good cause.
Sure.
This is what's going on in Boston. What's happening in outer space?
Yeah, so we jump cut to outer space, to the U.S. space shuttle. You remember those, Tim?
Oh, yeah, yeah. We saw the big SpaceX rocket launch today, but I missed those space shuttles.
They were peak 90s, I guess peak 80s, like, aesthetic. I really liked how they looked. They looked like a big coach bus that went into space. So the space shuttle goes for re-entry to the atmosphere with Major Beck Childs, played by Hilary Swank, on board as the co-pilot. The shuttle goes off course and ends up flying over Los Angeles in a Dodgers game.
Oh, I love that scene.
They fly over the L.A. River. It's kind of one of those iconic shots that you see in a lot of movies where the L.A. River, it's basically that. Looks like a drainage canal, concrete. The river is pretty low that day, fortunately, because of drought. And they're able to land. They land it, and they kind of crash it directly into these kind of a rig that a couple construction guys are working on. And it's like one of those scenes where the, you know, construction guy kind of looks in the window of the shuttle, and they look out, and it's like this sort of like aliens have landed, but kind of scenes. To editorialize a little bit here, I think this entire plot line is unnecessary and preposterous.
Sets the tone for the movie pretty good. It's like, yeah, we're just going to land the space shuttle in a drainage ditch, but that's how good our heroes are, right?
Right. Yeah. I guess it shows that she's like the best pilot. You know, but it's an interesting scene, and it kind of introduces Hilary Swank as the pilot. And we'll learn more about her later. But
you know, movies where you want to show someone as a good character, you save the cat, right? Isn't that the old phrase where you show someone saving a cat and you know that's a good person? If you want to know someone's a really good pilot, you land the shuttle.
That's true. That's true. And I guess it's, you know, that's the filmmaking cliche, you know, show don't tell. My brain is like wired. It's like, just tell us she's the best pilot and I'll believe you.
That's fine.
But then we're back to the researchers, right? So...
Yeah, so Josh Keyes figures out what's going on. He goes to try to find this, like, celebrity, top-notch scientist, Dr. Konrad Zimsky, played brilliantly in this movie by Stanley Tucci. Tucci is very dismissive, but he's kind of scared. He doesn't really know what this conclusion is, which could be the end of the world, that something's happening to the Earth's magnetic protection, the Earth magnetic field around it. So Tucci goes home, he freaks out a little bit more after reading these results, and he opens up a file cabinet, pulls out some classified materials to read. I'm not sure if there's a subplot of him getting in trouble with the FBI and National Archives, but he just has these classified files, and it seems like he knows something.
This is also where they introduce the only character-building elements around Stanley Tucci's character, I would say, which are that he is a massive jerk, and he loves cigarettes.
Yeah.
And that's basically it.
Yep,
and
yep.
He sort of plays those two things out for the rest of the 2 hours and 15 minutes of the movie. Sorry to interrupt.
No worries. He gets a lot out of that. We meet again this military guy from earlier. He knows Major Beck Childs, Hilary Swank's character. He meets, you know, he basically says, like, hey, you might get fired here because you messed up the shuttle, because they don't know why they went off course and why the shuttle was all screwed up and everything. But, you know, we'll learn here, because the sky is starting to get weird. There are these high-altitude static discharges, the movie says, causing, you know, crazy lights up in the sky. And then we realize something's off. So Tucci brings in, because he's the big top military scientist guy, he brings in Josh Keyes. He's very noticeably drunk, as he put here in the notes, but then very quickly sobers up.
Yeah, I mean, I'm, you know, when I go to a meeting at the Pentagon, I'm probably half as drunk. so four beers each on the table because he's with his French.
And to be fair, he was drinking because he thought the world was ending.
Right. They were like doing apocalyptic level drinking, like the world is going to end drinking. So no judgment there. But yeah, four beers, four shots each. FBI comes in. They haul him right into the Pentagon. And all of a sudden, he's sober as a geologist.
Yeah, he's not crusty anymore. No. So he's there. He's explaining about how the electromagnetic field around the Earth is falling apart. It's going to be bad. It's going to expose everybody to cosmic radiation. Why? Well, he thinks the outer core of the Earth, the inner core and the outer core. He says the outer core that they say spins like liquid is slowing down and no longer spinning. So this is going to be bad. It's going to destroy the electromagnetic field and cause the world to end. In a couple of months, there'll be superstorms. All of the electronics can be destroyed. Solar wind and radiation will cook the planet in a year. Not particularly great. And, you know, just because maybe these military people who have a career in catching things on fire and exploding don't understand that concept, he has to take a literal peach, cut it in half, describe what a peach pit is, and then light it on fire with a lighter and be like, see, it's like this.
That's right.
So they get the concept now. I did think it was funny because while I was watching this, I was like, oh, a pit, like a nuclear warhead core, which was actually named after a peach pit or like a fruit pit. So I was like, oh, well, it all fits.
There you go.
Science-wise, to slightly nitpick this, the electromagnetic field going away would like suck because there is some protection it provides to solar wind, but it doesn't really do much independently than our atmosphere does for things like microwaves, which the sun even doesn't really produce that much microwave radiation, mostly visible light and things like that. But it's just funny. It would hurt electronics, like the movie says, but it wouldn't necessarily impact human health as much as other things. They kind of confuse the electromagnetic field for the ozone layer.
Yeah.
Like a hole in the ozone would be bad for letting in cosmic radiation a lot more than losing the electric, because if you look at like history, the electromagnetic field has like changed multiple times over the course of Earth's history, and they did not cause mass extinction events. But
right.
Nevertheless, the movie posits that it's bad, and I imagine it wouldn't be great.
Yeah, I mean, there'd be no more podcasts. So
fair.
That would be enough. Yeah, I think this movie tries to do, it's, I don't want to say it's high concept, but it makes the audience think about something at the center of the Earth affecting what's happening
mm-hmm.
from space. And I think for a lot of Hollywood audiences, that's like maybe a bridge too far. Like the other film we're going to talk about tonight is Sunshine, where it gets really cold. That's you could wrap your head around that. You understand? Okay. And then like Armageddon, it's like big rock hits Earth, everything dies. But this is like, well, this thing is spinning mm-hmm. inside the Earth, and if that doesn't spin, then these other factors. It's a little. I mean, even for I don't want to criticize like the modern American or even global movie viewing audience, but it's like just an inch too technical, I think, for like it to be snappy. So I think they have to make it, like you're saying, they have to make it seem like much more ominous and apocalyptic than perhaps it is.
On a first read, if you're not following some of this stuff, it perfectly tracks. But if people are wondering why we're talking about this from a nuclear weapons podcast, well, here we go. So the military wants a solution, but Keyes is like, I don't know, man. You got to find some way to restart the Earth's core. I don't know how to do that. And you have to get to the Earth's core, which I don't know how to get there. Tucci has a solution. So at least for that second problem, he stole the research of this guy he used to work with, Dr. Braz, many years ago, who developed this ship. Tool called eventually calls Virgil that can use ultrasonic waves or something else, whatever, to dig holes really good. Kind of like melts or liquefies the rock in front of it, and the things can fly through, and then it solidifies again. And you test this out in the desert, and impresses them pretty good. He also conveniently invented this material called unobtainium, that kind of fun science term, movie term of, we need some sort of magic doohickey metal that can solve this problem. Let's call it unobtainium.
I combine the crystals in a tungsten titanium matrix at super cool temperatures. That's what did the trick.
The applications for this, it's...
What do you call this material?
I call it unobtainium. Unobtainium.
Mm-hmm. The unobtainium will take the heat and the pressure and transform it to energy, which in turn reinforces the shell, as you see. So the hotter and the deeper she gets, the stronger she gets. Theoretically.
like they do in Avatar, and if they put it around the digging machine, it also apparently can absorb heat and convert it to energy. So
it absorbs heat, converts it to energy, and also the more pressure it's under,
yeah, stronger it is.
The stronger it gets. Yeah,
sure. That they need that heat. Someone invented it. Terrific.
It's a strange metal. It's there's a lot of, like, they make like the two science leaps here. This is where the fiction comes in, I think, with the laser thing, and then also with the hull of the ship or the metal it's made out of.
But they have to still solve that first problem of what are they going to do to restart the Earth's core. So here's what they figure out. So after they build this digging ship, the super metal and the super laser in front of it, they're going to bring a bunch of nuclear devices, and they're going to explode at the same time and restart the Earth's core. And Zimsky thinks just about 2,000 megatons ought to do it. So they say, all right, they're going to take 5 200 megaton range nuclear warheads, bring those on board, just the right amount, that's very important, just the exact right amount of weapons that they're going to need, and that's going to do it.
Dr. Brazelton will supervise the building of a ship which is capable of reaching the center of our planet. Once there, it will deliver an explosive charge large enough to restart its core. Dr. Zimsky will calculate the scale of the explosion needed.
This is a program I designed to simulate the effect of nuclear detonations on the core. If my calculations are correct, a tiny nudge in any direction will force the core back into its normal flow.
What's a tiny nudge in planetary terms?
About 1,000 megaton, give or take.
Tops, because any more than that would create a core instability.
We made a few monster warheads in the 200 megaton range. Brass, do you think the ship can handle 5 of these babies?
Huh. If you would let me jump on this one for a little bit, because this is kind of more in my lane. I thought this was really interesting, because there aren't not 200 megaton nuclear weapons. They've never existed that we know of. The largest ever tested was 50 megatons. This was the very famous, in this, people who follow nuclear history, the Tsar Bomba test, the king of all bombs test the Soviet Union did in October 1961. Now, this could have theoretically shifted to 100 megatons if they just configured it a little bit differently. That was the largest ever tested. It weighed about 27 tons. It was a very large deployable device, but quite large. A very large bomb, but again, 50 could have been 100, not 200. The United States only ever deployed maybe a 9 megaton bomb. The idea behind this is that the more accurate your missiles can land, the less large your field needs to be, so that, like, you hit your target, you don't need a lot of wiggle room, and a lot of extra close only matters in horseshoes and hand grenades kind of thing. Megaton range bombs are pretty scary, but they never got to 200, but okay, in this world they do. Funny enough, when they see weapons being wheeled through and getting ready to be put onto this atomic train here, would you believe it? There are French flags on these warheads. I guess Serge, the scientist friend, came through and was able to contact some friends over in the French military and got them on the warheads. This is something really in bad French, like Atomic Commission of Energy or something like that. But I guess that's where they got the bombs. Not sure why they didn't pick them up in the United States or Russia, but heck, the French came through. I think currently, this is more today, these days, not in 2003 when the movie started, the Russians do have a decently sized warhead they could put around. Most of their stuff is around 800 kilotons, which is 1,000 tons on their Russian ICBMs. There's one, though, called the RS-36, which can carry between 8 and 20 megaton yield, but we don't really know how many what the size is.
Yeah, it is interesting. Well, there is a scene where they say, you know, like they show like the international cooperation scene where they show,
yeah,
presumably world leaders or scientists flying in. And there's some narration over that, I think by Aaron Eckhart, where it's, you know, this is like a global effort and all this stuff. There's no indication of that after that scene, other than the French scientist, I think.
yep.
So that's sort of, I feel like there's, I don't know this. I don't know the blue. I feel like there might be a deleted scene where there's something about, like, we have to get the fissile material from, or the bombs from.
They know how to build them this big, so let's have them do it.
Right. Maybe there's like, maybe they're doing what you're doing. There are no, or 200 megaton weapons. And
we don't have any that you know about, you know, that, right. Whatever.
Right. The other thing I think is that maybe again, maybe there's a missing scene where they have to like not inform, you know, because they're really trying to keep a lid on.
Yeah, they even hired this hacker named Rat, right. Whose job it is to control the flow of information and basically censor everything. He's one of the one of the good guys to stop the flow of information on the website and to censor everything. But
this is a classic late 90s, early 2000s movie trope where
you
need the hacker, the good hacker, right?
Yeah.
The black hat turned white hat. But it is actually legitimately shady. They're like, we need you to scrub the internet of any mention of this happening.
Yeah.
Like it is like that scene in Dark Knight at the end where, you know, Morgan Freeman's like, you know, this is a total where they use the phones to ping and you everyone's phone to ping and make like a sonar map of Gotham, and Morgan Freeman like can't abide it, and he's like, you know, I'm done after this is over. Spoiler, he wasn't. But it's like this movie does like a way worse thing with like zero moral consideration.
Crazy.
Great stuff.
I mean, it would have been interesting from the perspective of nuclear weapons. They're pretty bad, but we're going to find a good use for them, and we're going to find ways to, in times of crisis, to cooperate internationally, including these nuclear devices that can really be dangerous. Aaron Eckhart has this where he says,
"With luck, irony will break for the good guys for once, and the world's biggest weapons of mass destruction will help save the world. The ship will be powered by a small experimental nuclear reactor and will be divided into 6 compartments. Like cars on a train.
And the world's biggest weapons of mass destruction will help save the world. The ship will be powered also by a small experimental nuclear power reactor," which is also really important to know. But, you know, interesting stuff. But, all right, so we have going long here on the core. I think getting everything set up for what's going on in the film is more important than the step-by-step that they do once they get dropped in. But, you know, we see a montage, as we're supposed to in these kind of movies, of training and building, maybe a budding relationship between Keyes and Beck, potentially. We see some lightning superstorms. Rome gets toasted. For some reason, the Colosseum, which is made of stone, explodes because it gets hit by lightning. And it's time to drop the ship. So I actually kind of think this scene is pretty cool. They decide, for some reason, that the Mariana Trench is where they want to start. They say it's thinner there crest wise turns out that's the exact opposite. It's one of the thickest places where there's crest, but anyways, they decide to go there. So they take them out to like this deep drilling looking platform. They have the train. It's on like a space shuttle launching platform, but facing down, which I kind of caught was a pretty cool shot. The crew is Keyes, Beck, who's the co-pilot, Beck's commander from the space shuttle, who's the pilot, Zimsky, Serge, and Brass. So they drop the Virgil ship in. Some whales follow them because the laser that they use makes sounds that whales think is singing. It's important, I guess, for later. But anyways, I will fully admit, I tried my best to follow this movie. The scenes, maybe it's the special effects, maybe it's whatever, it was really hard to understand what was happening with the ship most of the time. Mm-hmm. Visually, it seemed more like it was inside a human body, which kind of makes sense because it was an MRI machine that they were using for like imaging.
Yeah.
It seemed like we were in the movie Inner Space, which is a good one if you haven't seen it yet to add to your list. Dennis Quaid and Martin Short is in it.
Oh, okay.
They're like get really small in a spaceship and fly through a human body.
Yeah. I was wondering whether this was a production choice. We don't have the budget to do like a very well the CGI, so we'll just show this stuff like through this kind of weird computer graphic MRI looking screen.
Yeah, because it's a ship traveling through rock. How visually interesting can that be?
Right.
But it's just very confusing about what is happening.
They do have a few shots in the movie of like later on where they do sort of like a profile shot of it actually traveling through rock, which is good. But I guess like again,
I think that doesn't make when I watched it, I was like I get it, but it's so confusing.
Yeah. It is confusing, yeah. And to your point about going long on the intro here, I don't think that's our fault, because this movie has, they don't enter the sea. I timed it. They don't enter the ocean to go into the earth until 53 minutes in. So this movie has 53 minutes of exposition before we finally into the earth.
It's like those Willy Wonka movies. The kids don't enter the chocolate factory until like an hour in.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, right.
You always forget that when you put on the movie, you're like, right, the mom sings for like 15 minutes. Okay. Yes. But
now, I think disaster movies do that. Like Armageddon is guilty of that. But Armageddon, it's a bit more entertaining, to be honest. But, you know, you got to get the gang together. I understand there's all the pieces that have to work. I will stop there because when we talk about Sunshine, there's a contrast here, but I will, yeah. I'll throw it back to you.
We're going to jump ahead here, because what happens essentially is we lose crew members here and there to death because they, like, get into accidents. They end up, like, finding an empty space, which is kind of insane, inside the Earth, where there's, like, a geode, a Grand Canyon, Crystal Grand Canyon, they call it. They start practicing arming the nuclear devices, or the babies, as the French guy puts it. The launch code is the kid's birthday. It's a lot, you know, some fun playing around with some of the nuclear things here. But then there's a big accident. There's a hole breach because they fly through diamonds. They dig through diamonds. And I guess they can't cut through those or whatever. But the ship gets hurt. The way that the ship works is if a compartment gets destroyed, there's like 6 or 7 compartments. If it gets destroyed so that the ship maintains its integrity, it will automatically, like, release that part of the train car.
Right.
The whole thing looks like one long train.
Yeah, I was gonna say, for the listeners, it's a big train,
big old train. So yeah. The French gentleman dies after giving the timers the keys because he doesn't make it out. This causes a little bit of a rift with some of the crew members. They keep going with the mission. Turns out, though, about 35 hours into the mission, once they get close to the Earth's core, it's too thin. So the energy waves from earlier with the 2,000 megatons of nukes is not enough.
Our speeds jump because the density of the core is different than our estimates. It's lighter than we thought.
Press.
Yeah.
Could you please punch the new core density into the equations for the nuclear detonation?
Failure?
You're telling me the 1,000 megatons of nuclear warheads we hauled down here isn't gonna cut it?
No. This core material's too thin.
What?
The energy waves from the explosion won't spread far enough. They'll just bleed away into nothing. That's it. We go home.
So they decide, I guess we failed. Zeminski decides, okay, he calls up the military, which I guess they can just do, even though they're almost in the center of the Earth. Their radio reaches to the surface of the Earth, and they say, Project Destiny is a go. And apparently that is a deep Earth seismic trigger initiative, something that Zeminski and the military thought that another adversary, like Russia or China or someone, was building, so they had to go build their own. There's this interesting little aside that Zeminski says where he's like, yeah.
It's a device. Deep Earth Seismic Trigger Initiative. We had reason to believe that our enemies were building a weapon that could generate targeted seismic events. They would be able to create massive earthquakes under our territory. No way of telling who did it.
So,
we built one too. MAD. Mutually Assured Destruction. A perfect acronym if ever there was one.
Oh, beautiful.
They built it first. I built it better.
We need one in case they use it against us. And they say that this weapon is so dangerous because the enemy could cause seismic and earth events and earthquakes, and we would never be able to know who did it. And I'll just point out, all of that makes sense. But Mutually Assured Destruction doesn't work if you don't know who's attacking you. Because you do not know who to retaliate against. That is literally one of the points behind it. How would you retaliate if there's a big earthquake somewhere that destroys San Francisco? What do you do? You don't know who did it, right? That they just said that. Otherwise, if you knew who did it, you would just nuke them, right? You don't have to earthquake attack them. You could destroy right. them with another whatever. It's just so funny. They literally, a second, they set it up why they did it. And the military is like, yeah, that makes perfect sense. Sure, we need one of these. It's using terms that people are aware of. MAD, Mutually Assured Destruction, retaliation. But if you don't know who's using the weapon against you, it doesn't matter if you have one. It's the same thing as if a country is able to, like in the movie, Some of All Fears, where we thought maybe the Russians had put a bomb in Baltimore to kill the president, but it was actually this like neo-Nazi terrorist who used and stole a bomb that was originally from Israel, all this different stuff. And they thought the Russians did it because the guy wanted to start a world war between the US and Russia. It's this attribution problem. If they can't figure out who did it using nuclear forensics or figuring out where the missile came from or whatever, you still are left with that situation. I've got all these bombs, but I've got no targets. So deterrence, yeah. The idea of hitting someone if they hit you, doesn't exist.
I think, and maybe we'll get into it later, this film nowadays, like a lot of films like this, will have like a retired military person, a retired CIA person, or someone from like the defense or security space to like kind of be an advisor on the script. I don't think they had that person in the writer's room. Is my guess.
Yep.
But, maybe I'm wrong. I haven't looked at the credits. Maybe there's a consultant on there, and I'm sorry if you're listening and I'm not giving you due credit, but
I'm going to guess that the person was like a me in the movie's writing room. And I'm in the back and I'm like, actually, no, that wouldn't make sense with deterrence. And they just turn to me and go, shut up. We pay you to sit there. don't want you to say anything, because I would ruin everyone's mood and destroy this pretty cool looking stuff. But anyway, so Keeves believes that Project Destiny may have actually been the reason why the Earth's core stopped spinning, which is probably what's happened, right? Project Destiny is Plan B, and Keyes and team try to build a Plan C, which is keep on digging, keep on trucking to the core, and figure out a solution. Zeminski tries to argue, but he gets punched by brats. So they keep going. All right, so because this is a disaster movie, of course the San Francisco Golden Gate Bridge has to be destroyed, and it is, with some cosmic radiation that gets through. The whole thing melts, but people are trapped in their cars. That's terrible. Traffic is already bad, let alone having to be melted. Anyways, we're in this situation. We're in a rush to time, right? We have to figure out a solution before Project Destiny is used, because Project Destiny would kill everybody aboard the Virgil. They figure out a solution, though. Bratz and Keyes and Zeminski work out a model where they're like, oh yeah, you know, while Zeminski is smoking that cigarette you mentioned earlier, he goes like, oh yeah, I figured this out. We could use wave interference and fluid dynamics to hotwire the nuclear weapons so that they are not exploded in one location, but can do five separate sequenced explosions. And I thought, as soon as they said this, my brain was like, you were going to explode all of the weapons at the exact same time? Because yeah, it doesn't matter how well you time these things. It's milliseconds, tiny little seconds for the weapon to explode and destroy the other ones. There's no perfect timing in that front. It's called fratricide in nuclear war planning. When you want to put two warheads on a target, you have to time them really well so the second one doesn't come in and get destroyed before it has a chance of exploding on its own. But anyways, they decide to time it so that
no one left alive is a nuclear physicist or a weapons expert. These are two geologists and a pilot.
And they're not like, this isn't Apollo 13. They're not calling back to Houston and troubleshooting stuff. They didn't call like Oppenheimer's long lost cousin or something and work it out on the ground.
There's no phone a friend, no.
No. But they decide they're going to hotwire them so that they explode, and then like further down, then explode another one. Okay, so they rewire the nukes. This is 42 hours into the mission. They're almost there at the Earth's core. They decide that they're going to store each of the weapons in one of the Virgil compartments. So they like drop the compartments while they're digging further down or across the liquid core. This causes Bratz to have to sacrifice himself, so he does. He reconciles with Zeminski. Actually, kind of like that reconciliation scene. That was kind of nice. Essentially, they do this, and they say it has to be timed to the millisecond, and then they will outrun the shockwave. One of the craziest things I have ever seen in a nuclear movie that really, really got me annoyed. I'm sorry, this is coming across terribly, but like they figure out that they need more warhead yield. That calculation was a little bit off because they didn't factor for something. They need the bomb to be 30% bigger. MRI bias, they called it. So they have to make a bigger bomb, but they don't have 6 to 7 pounds of plutonium sitting around. So what they essentially decide to do is to take the core, the plutonium core of their nuclear power reactor that they have there. Again, probably actually not a plutonium core, because it's not the kind of thing you would put in for this kind of a reactor. But anyways, they just take the plutonium core out, carry it, and attach it next to the other bomb.
Sure.
Josh, for the last bomb, to make it larger, use the fuel rods from the reactor.
Ejecting. That is insane.
You mean that doesn't work? That doesn't work too?
You can't just take more plutonium and put it next to a warhead and be like, no, it's a bigger bomb. It's not like attaching a more C4 to a block of C4 that's going to explode. Or it's not like putting an extra barrel of gasoline next to an explosion to make the boom bigger. Nuclear warheads are configured in a very particular configuration that only happens when the atoms are very closely compacted together. Otherwise, it's too much open space. So they're stored for safety reasons in non-critical configurations. They're stored in a way so that there's open space, there's not spontaneous fission, they don't explode, but they have to compact them really closely, then start the reaction. And particular with the plutonium bombs, it's very important that you design those things what's called an implosion bomb. It's a circle. You take it from the size of, say, like a volleyball, and it gets compressed to the size of a golf ball. Then it explodes. It's very odd, but you have to have the right shaped explosives to condense it down. Otherwise, you don't get the right yield you want. What you're going to get with this situation of bringing a barrel of plutonium next to another nuclear bomb that's exploding is you get a dirty bomb. You get more plutonium dispersion, but that's not what they're trying to do. They're trying to make the bomb bigger.
Right.
Anyways, I know they don't care about having the Earth's core being, you know, more radioactive or whatever. It's just, I'm watching this thing and it's like, that's why have this scene in there? It doesn't add anything, except it takes the power away from the ship and leaves our last two crew members, Beck and Keyes, left kind of powerless, floating in liquid lava and the Earth's core. And that was, I was watching this and I was like, that just doesn't make any sense in a... People watching it have done a disservice, but maybe then no one cares. I just thought it was really funny.
Yeah, I think it's one of those, you know, the writers were like, well, more is better. Yeah. More is bigger.
There's few movies that make me just completely irrationally complain about stuff. This was one of them.
Well, I think later you'll allude to how the scientific community feels about the film.
So yeah.
Spoil that.
I mean, we'll get into it, but spoiler alert, it upset Dustin Hoffman, and that's not something you do.
Well, he's my favorite scientist, so.
All right, so finally, just to wrap up the movie really quickly, Virgil doesn't have enough energy, like we said, to get home after the bombs explode. The Earth is flowing, the molten core is spinning. That's terrific. Everyone at the command center starts cheering, which is always a fun sight.
Love a command center scene.
12 minutes, bombs blast is going to hit Virgil and destroy them, but they figure out they can use the unobtainium, the metal around the hull of the ship, to convert the heat that is around them into energy. They do that like very quickly and convert the power, all of that stuff, and they are able to fly away and get away. They get kind of stuck by the bottom of I guess they don't have the laser working anymore, but they don't need it because they just find that they can just use the magma flows to get home.
Mm-hmm.
Don't know why they didn't come in that way, if they can leave that way. The main thing is that they enter the Earth's crust and kind of get stuck like 300 feet or so underwater near Hawaii. No one knows that they're there. No one can find them because the power is out. But they use the machine. I thought they were out of power, but they use the sonic waves or whatever to make a bunch of whales come by and sing to them. And Rat, our hacker character, is able to figure out that they have to go find the whales.
Dramatic scene. Aircraft carrier is pulling away from the search zone. They've given up. And Rat, our hacker character, played by TJ Qualls, I think is the actor's name. Yeah. You've seen him in... He was in Road Trip. He's in a lot of kind of raunchy...
Mm-hmm. Early out of our league, out of your league,
yeah, he's always like the nerdy guy. He definitely has an archetype, but just screaming at the top of his lungs on the deck of the aircraft carrier, "You gotta find the world!" Just it's absurd. But
well, speaking of being on top of an aircraft carrier, so what I was reminded of was Star Trek IV, the Voyage Home. That scene where Chekhov and crew the Enterprise have to go back to Earth's past to save some whales and bring them back to the future to talk to a spaceship. Don't worry about it. But Chekhov starts running around to people because they're looking for a nuclear-powered aircraft carrier to get some fuel for the Enterprise or something, and they're like going around asking people, "Where are the nuclear vessels? The nuclear vessels?" Because he's got this accent.
"Excuse me, sir. Can you direct me to the naval base in Alameda? It's where they keep the nuclear vessels. Nuclear vessels. Hello, we are looking for the nuclear vessels in Alameda. Could you tell me where?"
"Ooh, I don't know if I know the answer to that. I think it's across the bay. In Alameda."
"That's what I said, Alameda."
Anyways, nuclear, aircraft carrier, whales, it all kind of fits. So everyone's safe, our characters are safe, and with Rat's help, they decide to release all the classified information on Project Destiny, on Virgil. It's no longer a secret. Okay, I figured people were going to ask questions when San Francisco exploded and Rome exploded, but at least we know what happened here, and that's the end of the core. And all of its fun science and nukes and everything else. We'll get into our rating system at the end of what we thought of that movie overall, but we have another one to cover.
We do.
Sunshine. And I want you to fly this particular ship into the sun.
Call me the captain of the Icarus 2. I'm very excited to be doing a plot summary of Sunshine. This film was directed by Danny Boyle. You may know him from Trainspotting, The Beach, 28 Days Later, Slumdog Millionaire, 127 Hours.
A lot of hits.
Academy Award winner. in this case, he was accompanied by screenwriter Alex Garland, Ex Machina, Annihilation, Dread. This is a $40 million film that made $32 million and in the I think global box office. I'm not sure if global box office. So one of the rare films that actually loses money. Usually most films have a modest profit. This film did not. This film lost $8 million, but it has a 76% fresh rating on Rotten Tomatoes. And it's developed, I think, I don't want to say a cult following, but it's developed, I think, a loyal fan base since 2007.
Yeah, no, I know. You're the head of the fan club.
I am, yeah. Vote me. I'm self-appointed secretary of the committee. so...
Our sun is dying. Mankind faces extinction. 16 months ago, I, Robert Capa, and a crew of seven left Earth frozen in a solar winter. Our mission, reignite the sun before it's too late. Welcome to Icarus 2. So if you wake up one morning, and it's a particularly beautiful day, you'll know we made it.
So I think I mentioned when we were discussing the core that has 53 minutes of exposition. This movie has 40 seconds of exposition. I timed it earlier today. Mm-hmm. Just briefly, I'll just read it. I can literally read it to you. Our sun is dying. Mankind faces extinction. 7 years ago, the Icarus Project sent a mission to restart the sun, but that mission was lost before it reached the star. 16 months ago, I, Robert Capa, and a crew of seven left Earth frozen in a solar winter. Our payload, a stellar bomb with a mass equivalent to Manhattan Island. Our purpose, to create a star within a star. 8 astronauts strapped to the back of a bomb. My bomb. Welcome to the Icarus 2.
Tight. That's a tight intro.
That's a tight intro. And the first 40 seconds he delivers, and then he pauses, and then like 10 seconds, and then delivers last line, a bomb. So it's about a minute in total. And then you're on the ship and you don't know about these people's lives. You don't know about what they did before. You know nothing. And you are just on the ship with them and you are hurtling towards the sun. So
you didn't need like 40 minutes of birds starting to get cold and flying south for the winter earlier than they normally would. You didn't need a business meeting interrupted because they're like, turn the heat up. It's too cold in here. No, you didn't need 40 minutes of that.
No, this movie is 107 minutes. So it's under 2 hours. It's a lean film, which I love. So basically it's 2057. The sun is dying. There's basically like a new ice age that's happened on Earth. You don't see any of this. You're just told this through the brief exposition and the framing of the mission. The Icarus Project was a project that tried to restart the sun 7 years ago, but it failed to reach the sun. They don't know what happened. Again, probably one of the worst names for a mission to the sun.
Literally named after a character in Greek mythology who flew too close to the sun and wasn't able to make it and died. And once that happened to fail, they're like, let's try it again. Icarus 2.
Yeah, let's try it again. Let's not give it a new name like Sun Chaser or Spark, or I don't know, something that like
Pelor. Something.
Yeah. Zippo.
Yep.
They basically have invented, and I'll ask you, Tim, to jump in here before we dive in too mm-hmm. deep, but they basically invented something called the stellar bomb, which is the mass equivalent of Manhattan Island. This includes all the fissile material on Earth, and it's been put inside this payload, which is not inside the ship, really is, it is the ship, basically. Yeah. And they're going to fly this ship to the sun with this big payload on the front, jettison it into the star with the hopes of restarting it. So I guess we would say, if you have some comments here about sort of the, I guess we're not talking about the feasibility, but I guess I have a question for you to kick this off. Is this the largest bomb ever depicted in popular media?
Definitely the largest one that seems to be leaning into like nuclear physics. There's been big explosions and things like this, but this is, they describe it as all of the Earth's fissile material went into building the first Icarus bomb and then the second one. So there's nothing left. So in this world, there are no more, maybe, I imagine there's no more nuclear weapons because probably convert that stuff into the bomb. The movie mostly talks about, I think it's not in the film, but in the script, and when the director and the kind of like science team behind it were talking about it, they mostly referred to uranium fissile material as opposed to plutonium. Uranium is what you can mine. Plutonium is what is a byproduct of burning uranium. But they have a lot of it. And so this would definitely be the largest, because they've all of the Earth's fissile material put in together for these two bombs. So I would say that. I mean, the Manhattan Islands, it's pretty big. I Googled this and Thrillist.com told me that the weight of Manhattan Island is like 125 million tons. You know, 125 megatons? No, it's very, very heavy. They did say, though, that they talked a lot with some real-life scientists on this. One in particular, a very famous University of Manchester physicist named Brian Cox. Not the Super Trooper secession star, but another very famous one. And he was part of this kind of research team, and he convinced the filmmakers to scale down the size of the bomb from the moon to Manhattan Island. Although in the deleted scene that you showed me, they did get it in there that said, like, it was the weight of the moon or something. Like, they had to get that in there or whatever.
This space is dark matter of equal mass to the moon, compressed into the size of a football stadium. Within this space at our command, a single spark will pop into existence. And then that spark will split into two. And then those will split again, and again, and again, and again. And before you know it, a reaction that generates more energy than it consumes. A big bang on a small scale. A glimpse at the dawn of time. I think it'll be beautiful. I'd like to see it. I can live without going home.
But yeah, I would say this is pretty big. And I think them referencing Manhattan as like the mass size equivalent gotta be, right? Like I referenced to the Manhattan Project, the codename for the building the first original bomb. Maybe it's too obvious to be clever, but like it was fine. It got across the point, which is this thing is the size of a football stadium.
Right. And later on, they show you the inside of the payload, and it is like it looks like a football arena, basically made of weapons, basically of the payload.
You can't describe. I've no. There's no real. It's a fake thing. They create basically a sci-fi weapon that they say they combine dark matter into it as well. So it's uranium fission to ignite dark matter to make an explosion. So it's a nuclear bomb that caught, you know, and that's interesting because there's these things called hydrogen bombs or fusion bombs, these thermonuclear bombs, much like with the sun, that is essentially burning hot, so hot that it's fusing elements of hydrogen together, which also produces an incredible amount of energy. When you either fuse atoms together or take them apart, they release more energy than it takes to actually split them or fuse them together. So in a thermonuclear bomb, the way that means is you take the X-ray or energy and heat from a fission reaction to fuse together elements of hydrogen. And you basically create a secondary stage. That fusion produces the largest portion of a bomb, which is why you can get to the megaton range in the first place. So all those bombs in core are all thermonuclear 2-3 stage bombs, and they've designed them to be really, really large because they'll do a fission to fusion to fission. You throw in tritium, you throw in more plutonium, several cores, and you can get that configuration just right so that it has the largest amount of fission or fusion and uses the amount of fissile material as efficiently as possible, because most of the fissile material is destroyed in the blast before it has a chance to separate or fuse together. But this configuration of this stellar bomb, I mean, who knows? They look basically like it's one giant cube when you see it later, but inside that is like rows and rows and stacks of cubes. It almost looks like if you've seen the show Chernobyl, where they show the inside of the reactor and it's a bunch of fissile material stacked in pillars, a little like rods, and they're stacked in a square configuration. It's like thousands of those together. So that's kind of what imagery I'm getting. And then it's a bunch of those blocked together. I would say it probably, if you wanted to close your eyes and visualize it, it's a lot like a Rubik's Cube in terms of what it looks like, made of dark matter. So in 50 years or so, we figured out dark matter and put it onto a ship, covered it with uranium, and we're going to blow it up. That's all I can do to help. That's literally what it is.
That's the plan, yeah. And it's, I think the way they, we'll talk a little more about the interior configuration later, but I think the ship is designed in a really cool way.
It's it looks really interesting.
Sort of the inverse of an ICBM, intercontinental ballistic missile, where you think of like, you know, the big tube with the small payload on top. Mm-hmm. This is kind of the opposite. It's this very narrow ship with like the living quarters and the garden and all these sort of things that we'll talk about. But then the entire front is this massive sun shield, and behind the sun shield is the payload. So most of the ship is the payload. That it's I guess because of space science, this is all okay. This can work.
The motif, the kind of design aesthetic from real life International Space Station, Skylab's whole kind of what it looks like in real life, right. But then obviously scaled up. And it takes also the same kind of approach that one of my favorite books and TV series takes, which is The Expanse, which is if you have spaceships that don't actually have to enter the atmosphere, they're going to look different than what you think that they look like, because they're going to be pretty rudimentary, because in space there's no drag. It's going to be designed for long-term travel. It's going to look kind of ugly compared to the kind of Star Wars ships that you may, envision that have to go through or land in the atmosphere and stuff. So, like, they'd have, like, various tubes and wires and rotating comms towers and all that stuff. It looks cool. I will say that design-wise with this movie, the tone it sets, I'm in, and I was on board for this, and they really very quickly draw you in.
Yeah, visually, it's awesome. Lots of gold. The spacesuits they use are gold, which we'll talk about in a minute. Yep. The front and all the shields look gold. And with the yellow of the sun and the gold on the ships, it's a very cool look. You don't see a lot of, like, gold in sci-fi. You see, like, a lot of silver and, like, cooler tones. And it's kind of interesting to use, like, these really hot sort of colors to kind of, I think, emphasize, like, the heat, I guess. Yep. But,
well, speaking of being able to absorb the heat, like, let's talk about one of the main reoccurring locations in the movie. They don't have a spray tan booth on board, but they have a place to sit and get a tan.
Yeah, they've got the probably the best tanning bed in the solar system. They have a window on the front of the shield. So I guess it's kind of weird. I think they take some liberties with the layout of the ship, because the payload is supposed to be in the front behind the shields, but then there also is an observation room where you can look directly at the sun. The computer is also called Icarus, so one character asks Icarus to show him the sun at 3% brightness, and Icarus says at 3%, you'd be blinded, but I can show you 2.6%. This window allows them to view the sun from safety, and there's some awesome shots of the sun kind of filtered through this lens where it's just like this massive ball of fire, which is, I think, is an important part of the movie. These rooms come into importance, I think, later in the movie. So before I talk to that, I guess I should tell you who's in the film.
Yeah.
Quickly, it's a small, unlike Core, where it's a very big cast, there are, by my count, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 characters in this movie, plus the computer, Icarus. So the main character is Robert Capa, played by Cillian Murphy, brilliant Irish actor. He's the physicist who operates the stellar bomb. This is Robert Capa, not Robert Opie Oppenheimer. I think in July we'll probably be doing maybe a couple episodes dedicated to that.
Oh, yeah. So I fully, the whole time while watching this movie was like, whoa, so he's a physicist designing a stellar bomb, and he's, like, kind of in love with what the bomb can do, and it's like, he's also going to play Robert Oppenheimer in an upcoming movie directed by Christopher Nolan. The cast for that movie is also stacked. And I'm excited for what that history, what that film is going to be portraying. But you're watching this. I wonder if Nolan was like, oh, well, I've had Murphy in a lot of my movies as, like, third, fourth build guy. Let's bring him on fully on board. And he already has the acting past performance to portray this kind of physicist, nuclear bomb character. He probably still has his security clearance, so he's in good shape.
He's good at playing a tortured soul, and I think Oppenheimer probably falls into that category. As does Robert Capa.
So this actor plays some Batman villains in other movies, Christopher Nolan stuff.
Scarecrow.
Right, yeah. So we have to balance it out with some Avengers in here. So what Avengers actors do we have in here?
Well, we have Captain America, Chris Evans, playing James Mace. He's the engineer. He is sort of he's sort of the alpha male on the ship, I'd say. I don't want to call him a jerk. I think he's just like not the captain, but he thinks he's like the big guy, big man on campus, kind of. And he has that kind of energy. We have Rose Byrne, brilliant actor from Australia. She is the pilot, her character's name is Cassie. We have Michelle Yeoh as Corazon, the biologist.
Academy Award winning.
Academy Award winner, who she's responsible for, like, the gardens. She's really into gardening, which is important on the ship because that's how they create their oxygen. So they have a full garden on the ship, which also supplies them with fresh vegetables for cooking, but also oxygen for breathing. Cliff Curtis as Searle, the ship's doctor and psychological officer, who is one of the more interesting characters in the movie, more about him later.
He loves hanging out in that tanning booth.
He does. He loves getting a tan. And we have Hiroyuki Sanada as Kaneda, the ship's captain. Brilliant Japanese actor. We have Benedict Wong as Trey. He's the navigator. And Troy Garrity as Harvey, the communications officer and second in command. Also, I think the singular nominee for what would you say you do here on the ship in terms of your job? It'll become clear later on that Harvey doesn't really have a role to play.
Whose cousin are you? Are you the NASA director's cousin? But yeah, Benedict Wong, also another Marvel alum for all of those films. But I like this ship design. You see a lot of creature comforts, right? You got like the food, the vegetables. There's legitimately like just like a kitchen. There's gravity. They're not playing around with like space tube food or anything. They're straight up enjoying the food.
It's a very humane environment, it seems like. And they seem like kind of very balanced individuals who have their beefs with one another, but it's not like they're all just kind of normal scientist people on a ship. They're the type of people you would expect to pass a NASA psychological evaluation to be on a mission to save the world. They're not. There are some hotheads, there are some moments of tension, but everyone is mostly like there's a deleted scene where there's playing chess. And it's like, I imagine that's what most of the time is like.
This is obviously going to be, spoiler, a bit of a contrast to the Icarus One. But also, I think it's really interesting to see these comforts and the people acting the way that they are, because the undercurrent that they talk about a lot is most of them don't actually expect this to be a return trip. They're on a suicide mission. There's some small chance that maybe they're going to be able to release the shield, drop the bomb, ride the wave back home. But I don't think most of them actually believe that that's the case. Pretty much their entirety of their mission is just, it doesn't really matter who makes it there. Someone needs to drop the bomb. Right. So they tend to approach every kind of challenge that way. They try to keep their humanity while also recognizing they're doing this for a bigger thing. Some of them are doing it to save people. Other ones are maybe doing it to see what the bomb can do and the beauty that it will produce. Nevertheless, it is an interesting contrast of the creature comforts versus, you know, they know where this is going to end.
That's kind of the setup. It's like a very, like you're saying, Tim, and like I was saying, it's like, it seems like a very well organized and run ship. After 16 months traveling towards the sun, they encounter some solar winds earlier than they think they would, which means they can't send their last communications packets back via radio or comms towers. So they basically have 24 hours to send their last messages. Capa, the physicist, takes a lot of time recording his message. So long that James Mace, the engineer, can't send his message back home, his final message. So they get into a little bit of a fight. This is sort of sets up the tension between them for the rest of the movie. Captain of Icarus 2 watches a video message of Icarus's one captain, who you might recognize as Mark Strong. The captain's name is Pinbacker. He talks about a beautiful wave that hits the ship, but it's a very like sort of chaotic kind of scrambled message. The crew flies by Mercury, so they see Mercury crossing, kind of doing the orbital path across the front of the sun, or the side of the sun they're on.
And I remember, how close is Mercury relative to the other planets? My very educated mother just served us 9 pizzas. Okay, it's at the beginning.
It's the closest planet. Yeah. It's the closest planet, yeah. They see that it's beautifully shot. You know, it looks like just like a marble kind of moving across this massive...
Beautiful shot in the movie.
Beautiful shot. This movie does not mess around when it comes to beautiful visuals. It's extremely moving. They're all in the observation chamber. They're watching Mercury go by, and you feel like you're in there with them. You're like, you're witnessing this kind of remarkable thing that no other human has ever seen, at least humans that are alive.
And then we hear some beeping.
So Mercury's iron core has amplified the distress signal from Icarus One. This is discovered by the comms officer, basically the only useful thing he's done on the trip, and other than allow them to send their, you know, Skype videos back home. And basically this creates a big debate with the crew. Basically, we know that Icarus One is there. It's sending a signal. We can triangulate where it is. It is going to be 10,000 miles or 15,000 miles from where we're going to go. Nothing in space terms. We can divert our course. We can go there. The question is, should we go? They have this debate and they all agree we shouldn't go to rescue them if anyone is still alive after 7 years, because that would be a massive abdication of our commitment to our mission, which is to save humanity and the Earth. However, the point is raised by the psychologists on board. If their payload is intact, then we have another opportunity. You know, everything is entirely theoretical, whether this bomb is going to work. So if we have two bombs, we double our chances of restarting the star. They have a bit of a discussion, but then, you know, someone says, we're not a democracy, we're scientists.
We'll have a vote.
No, 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 we won't. We're not a democracy. We're a collection of astronauts and scientists. So we're going to make the most informed decision available to us.
Made by you, by any chance?
Made by the person best qualified to understand the complexities of payload delivery. Our physicist.
Capa is the one most qualified to make that call as a nuclear physicist. So Capa is sort of burdened with this question of whether or not to divert.
I thought it was so interesting that the physicist makes this call, because I think the terminology he's using, the choices about having extra bombs to complete the mission, reminded me of nuclear war planners.
Reliability of projection has dropped below 45%. Remaining projection is not open to useful speculation.
That's the problem right there. Between the boosters and the gravity of the sun, the velocity of the payload will become so great, space and time will become smeared together. Everything will distort, everything will be unquantifiable.
You have to come down on one side or the other. I need a decision.
It's not a decision, it's a guess. We've mined all Earth's fission materials for this bomb. There's not going to be another payload. The one we carry is our last chance. Our last, best. Two last hopes are better than one.
Basically deciding if you want to destroy a hardened cover of a silo on the enemy's weapons, and you're trying to make sure you destroy it, you have to calculate, and I used to do these calculations, where you would determine, all right, how accurate are my weapons? 50% of the time they land where you want them to. So with this size of a warhead, I need, with this accuracy and what's the target that I'm trying to hit with its, how durable is it, to increase my chance of it being destroyed to a level that you feel satisfied by the planning you need to follow through with this mission, I'm going to need 3 warheads on the target. Because one of them will miss, one of them will maybe fizzle, and one will hit. So it's the same kind of calculation, which is the reason why we ended up during the Cold War with tens of thousands of nuclear weapons, because this is the strategy. There are this number of targets. You know, you can come up with all kinds of targets. You can pick one target. You can pick a million targets in another country. If you pick, 1,000, you're going to need 3,000 to hit them, because you want to make sure you have that number. You don't just need one per target. You need X number per target based on how accurate your weapons are and how reliable they are to go boom when you want them to. This is the same calculation that feeds into what Robert Capa is talking about. So I don't think it's intentional, but that terminology around bombs and things is the same kind of thought that nuclear war planners put into. And this is also the calculations that military people will make in the United States when you talk about, all right, we have currently 1,500 or so nuclear weapons deployable missiles or bombers or submarines. If I want to get to 1,000 or in 800, it's this calculation that will go into whether or not the military will tell you if it's agreeable or not. And then it's up to the civilians to reduce the number of targets or to change the strategy to fit the process. But anyways, I think it's that hard, cold calculations that happens in real life. The movie at least is paralleling that, if not intentionally cribbing it.
Well, we could talk about more of the human elements versus like technocratic elements later, but basically Capa is running the calculations. The computer who's like running the simulations say it's inconclusive. He just has to,
yeah.
I believe it says, it would be speculative to go any further. So,
right. I think he rolls a D6 and it's a 4 through 6 is go. Right. 1 through 3 is not, and it lands on 4.
So I think the captain comes to the Capa, and he needs a decision, and all the science, all the training, all the PhDs, all the diplomas on the wall. Capa says, "Well, 2 bombs is better than 1."
and for a second, I thought I saw General Turgidson from Dr. Strangelove coming through.
So that's how the decision's made. The nuclear physicist makes it. Capa makes it. Our protagonists, basically, they divert to the Icarus One. They dock successfully. They open the door, and everything is covered in dust. Someone makes a joke about, well, dust is 90% human skin.
Mm-hmm.
This is where the movie kind of makes this pivot to being more of a thriller, more of a horror movie, more in line with like Alien versus your traditional sci-fi genre film.
Good to note it. This is, for me, a pivotal point in the movie.
They go around the ship. The ship has plenty of oxygen. They're not wearing spacesuits. They're wearing kind of COVID-19 masks, basically to filter out dust, but they're not wearing much else. They go around the ship. The garden on the ship has been growing unchecked for 7 years. The ferns are bursting out of the ceiling. I mean, they're really excited because they realize that they can perhaps move the plants or move the oxygen.
Which is really important because we didn't talk about it. There was an accident. There was a fire on Icarus 2. Also, the captain died because of a mistake that Benedict Wong, the navigator, made when he was... all, you know, we're not going through everything, but there was the captain's dead, Benedict Wong is on suicide watch, and the oxygen is depleted, and they need more oxygen in order to be able to make that return trip.
Right. So the crew is down at this point to, they're on the ship. The ship violently undocks. The Icarus One violently undocks from the Icarus Two. And basically the four guys who were doing sort of the mission on the Icarus One have to get back to the Icarus Two. There's one functioning spacesuit. There are four people, and the airlock needs to be opened manually, meaning that one person will need to stay behind. Our psych officer, who has been basically spending the entire movie getting a tan in the observation room, who is like slowly deteriorating, who, when the captain was being burned alive by the sun, is on the radio with him, you know, asking, "What do you see? What do you see?" who is basically like going crazy, sort of valiantly offers to stay behind. Capa, as the most important, least expendable member of the crew, because he's the only one who can operate the payload. This is another sort of shift from the core, where they realize you need the expert to be alive.
Or to simply have one on board would be nice too.
Or simply have one on board, yeah. So Capa is given the spacesuit, and these are these kind of gold, very claustrophobic spacesuits, which are like, you feel like you can barely move in them.
They look like they look awesome. They're they basically look a little bit like deep sea mining suits, but gold, yeah. And really like a very thin, instead of a circle see through, it's a very thin slit. Yeah. For the sun blocking.
But if you were inside one, you would look like you're in like a coffin, one of those like torture devices, like an Iron Maiden almost. Mm-hmm. Like it's like that kind of vibe. So he gets the spacesuit. Chris Evans and second in command, who is actually now captain, they strip the insulation from the sides of the inside of the ship, wrap themselves in it, because they're going to be propelled. When the airlock is open, they'll be propelled 20 meters, I believe, through space to the other airlock where they'll go in. But since they don't have spacesuits, they'll be subject to, I think, minus 236 Celsius, so cold. Very cold. So they wrap themselves in this insulation. The airlock is blown. They're shot across. Of course, it doesn't go right. Troy Garrity goes spinning off into space. There's this very kind of brutal scene where they show him like freezing incrementally, and then he exhales and his, you know, body freezes. And then they show his body hitting a comms tower, you know, pieces shatter, and there's like frozen blood that kind of spews out. Capa makes it the airlock. He grabs, sort of heroically grabs Mace, pulls him in. They pressurize the airlock, open the door. Mace kind of takes his hand out, and it's frostbitten. And it's a pretty like grisly kind of body horror scene. Capa is fine if distressed, but the question remains, you know,
how did the docking blow and
you know what happened?
Because on Icarus One, we learned that like for some reason all of the crew were in that Centan observation tower, right, area, and they're all crisped. They're burnt to ash, basically. That's where the ash is, you know,
desiccated.
Someone opened up the sun observation more than 2.56% or whatever and toasted them.
Right. They're back on the ship. They don't have enough oxygen. And this becomes a point of discussion. There are, I believe at this point, five crew members on the ship. One of them is played by Benedict Wong, who messed up the calculation to begin with, who has been sedated. They surmise that it may have been him who sabotage the docking, but Capa points out, you know, he's so doped up, he sleeps 23 hours a day. They have a vote about whether or not they're going to kill him, basically, so that the four remaining crew members have oxygen. Everyone but Rose Byrne's character, Cassie, votes to kill him. She refuses to do it. Mace, kind of being the alpha male sociopath that he is, I guess. That's unfair, but we can discuss that in the, I guess, when we're after done with the recap. But
he makes the tough decisions that no one else will do.
That's I think how he would frame it. Yeah. He goes to the infirmary to get a scalpel to kill Benedict Wong's character. There's a scene here where he opens the scalpel drawer and he doesn't notice that there's two scalpels missing. So he takes out a scalpel and there's two scalpel slots with two scalpels missing. And there are these weird like space scalpels that for some reason like oscillate. Like there's a button and they...
Yeah, it's like a sonic toothbrush or something.
Like a sonic toothbrush. It's like, I thought you'd probably want like a steady hand when you're cutting. Like, I don't know what the purpose of these are in a medical sense. If there's any doctors listening, surgeons...
Yeah, right into the show. Would you prefer that your blade violently oscillated while you were operating?
Yeah. I mean, it sounds like you'd be headed for a super critical, you know, vein puncture, but he goes to kill Benedict Wong. Benedict Wong has already killed himself. He sees him there, wrists are slit. He's laying there bleeding out in the Earth room. And then things start to escalate quickly. A lot of stuff happens in rapid succession. The motherboards that power the ship are submerged in this like coolant liquid. These things are pulled out of the coolant, so the ship's computers no longer function. Capa realizes he's in the payload area. He realizes, because Icarus tells him, that you don't have enough oxygen to make it to the payload delivery.
Capa, warning. You will not live long enough to deliver the payload.
Please clarify.
12 hours before crew will be unable to perform complex tasks. 14 hours before crew will be unable to perform basic tasks. Journey time to delivery point, 19 hours.
It's impossible, Karzan. I'm certain we have remaining oxygen to keep 4 crew alive.
Affirmative. 4 crew could potentially survive on current
Trey
reserves.
Trey is dead. There are only 4 crew members.
Negative.
Affirmative, Icarus. 4 crew. Mace, Cassie, Karzan, and me.
5 crew members.
Icarus.
Yes?
Who's the 5th crew member? Where is the 5th crew member?
In the observation room.
So basically, at this point, it's established there's an intruder on the ship.
Ooh.
That's the 5th crew member who is sucking up all the oxygen that they need. He says, where is the crew member? Where is the fifth person? They say, in the observation room. Kappa goes to the observation room and kind of see this shadowy figure, naked, just like the outline of like kind of a male physique.
Yep. You never really see a good look of the captain.
Right. You never really see the look of the monster, the captain. And it's Pinbacker, and he's there. He slashes Cillian Murphy's character, slashes Capa. At this point, it just becomes kind of like a monster slasher thriller kind of thing. He's going, Capa manages to kind of pin him behind an airlock, which buys him some time in this. While this all is happening, Chris Evans' character, Mace, is trying to lower the mainframes back into the coolant so that he can activate the computer system so they can function again. I will also say that, number one, I think they do a really good job in this movie of, like, there's, like, differences in temperature. Like, if there's the heat of the sun and then there's, like, this super cool liquid. Also, Chris Evans manages to do this. He manages to get these things back in, but I think he dies, like, the most horrific death of the film in doing so. Like, someone is burnt by the sun, some people are stabbed, people like slit their throats, people are frozen in the ether of space, but like he like slowly freezes to death. He slowly freezes to death from the bottom half up in a vat of like anti or super freeze. I don't even know what it is. It's horrific. It's like very graphic and very grim,
which is ironic because in addition to playing Captain America, he also played the Human Torch in the Fantastic Four movie. So it's a weird way for the Fantastic, Human Torch to go, to freeze. But yeah, it's pretty rough. You mentioned people getting stabbed. Corazon gets stabbed in the back by Pinbacker right after she realizes that one of the plants survived the fire. And she was so excited about that. And then she gets stabbed and gets kind of left positioned in a way that looks like she's worshiping the plant by Pinbacker.
Yeah.
You know, we're almost near the end of the movie, but like, do we get a sense, like, what's your perspective? Why is Pinbacker doing this? Because he went insane, I guess, arguably. He killed his crew on Icarus One. He left Icarus One right where it needed to be to, if there was ever going to be another mission, to hopefully like draw them in. And he was waiting there for 7 years, as he says later in the film, talking to God, the sun.
For 7 years, I spoke with God. He told me to take us all to heaven.
What is his motive? Why is he doing what he's doing? He draws seemingly like from potentially like, what is the, I forget the character's name from Apocalypse Now by Marlon Brando.
Kurtz.
Yeah. There's clearly a lot of that. He looks like him in a way.
Yeah.
With his skin burnt instead of covered in, you know, mud and stuff. But what do you think of what he's trying to get across?
It is a spiritual film in a lot of ways, and it sort of brings like the existence of God or a God or some kind of higher power into question, not directly, but I think indirectly. Pinbacker and the and Searle, played by Cliff Curtis, are sort of on Icarus 2, it's Cliff Curtis, on Icarus 1, it's Pinbacker. It's like they are entranced, intoxicated, somehow obsessed with the sun. The closer they get, the more they want to be exposed to it. And I think they see it as like filling a god role in their lives. And I think, you know, that seems absurd, obviously, like from our her perspective. But I mean, historically, like the sun was a god, right? I mean, this is like a thing, the thing that's like a constant in human civilization for millennia before the introduction of science and Right, exactly. But I think it's particularly potent in the context of the film when you are in a, you're in a, not a post-apocalyptic world, but you're in an, in a world that's experiencing the beginning of an apocalypse or a beginning of a, the extinction of life. It's like, maybe people would adopt these ideas or be influenced that way. They're literally passengers on things that are like the pinnacle of man-made achievement, the pinnacle of science and technology. They're approaching something which is like perhaps the pinnacle of nature's power, like at least in the sense that we know it. So they're in awe of it, and maybe awe can lead to infatuation, and infatuation can lead to fanaticism, and fanaticism can lead to murder, I guess. I don't know. They're, I mean, as a former kind of terrorism guy, not a practitioner of that, but a practitioner of the policies surrounding it, maybe they're radicalized by the sun. I don't know. That's sort of my take on it, I guess. Like this extreme power that feel welcomed by and warmed by and a part of and embraced by, they become acolytes of and worshipers and servants. And I don't know.
It really, really speaks to their soul.
Yeah.
SOL. Yeah, no, I think that makes a lot of sense. And it also interesting parallels between our psych person, Cyril, and Pinbacher. They both kind of approach it differently. You know, they're both infatuated with it, but one of them is fairly peaceful about it. And the other one is like, hey, I'm going to murder the whole of humanity about it. Like,
right.
They have different things that they take away from that same common attraction.
Right. And I think that's actually a fairly common, like, radicalization path. Like, some people, you know, become radicalized, but perhaps they're not violent, and some people become radicalized and they become violent. I mean, this is, you know, we talk about this a lot in the terrorism space, between people who are radical in like a religious sense but nonviolent, and then some people are radical in a religious sense and violent. I mean, this is a pretty common territory. So I don't think the film is intending to do that, but maybe we can put that lens on it if it works for us. At this point, basically, it's kind of reality starts to like distort. Capa makes it to the payload. Rose Byrne is dead. As we mentioned, everyone is dead but Capa and the villain, basically, the Captain of Icarus One, Pinbacker. So they're in the payload area. It's like a massive football arena cube thing. They really do a good job of making it almost impossible to visualize and understand and comprehend.
Right.
I mean, it's that big. It's not like it's one room. It seems like it's a room with stairs that go down, and then there's like another football field. It is huge. And they do a great job of making it just seem so big.
A small thing, and it's just not really that important, but I kept thinking when they were saying, oh yeah, we're going to run out of oxygen, it's like, well, just don't put all of your air in that giant stadium room, because they're walking around there with no mask. It's like, don't.
That's actually a really good point.
Get the air out of there, man. Like, you have an entire stadium filled of air in this gigantic, maybe the air is, I don't know, like dark matter radiation or whatever, but like, you know, don't oxygenize that, man. Just use that air, but whatever, it's a small thing.
No, that's a good point.
But we've been talking about too much cool stuff that's not about nukes and not about bombs, so let's wrap up here with the bomb bit. What do you see?
You know, they asked Capa earlier in the film, like, what is it going to be like? And he says, what is the explosion going to be like, the detonation? He says, I think it's going to be beautiful. He wants to touch it, and when all the dust settles, when it's just him alone with his bomb, you see, they kind of tease this earlier in the film. It's like one spark leads to two sparks, leads to three, leads to four sparks, leads to eight sparks. You know, this exponential,
a supercritical reaction.
Supercritical reaction happening. It goes off. This is sort of intercut with the payload itself flying into the sun. So you see the exterior shot, and then the interior shot of Capa. The flame wall is coming towards him, and you think it's going to vaporize him. You think it's going to be like a grisly scene where, you know, it's like his body being melted. But it's him, and he's just like bathed in the flame, bathed in the bomb, and he's smiling. The reaction is happening, and he is in the middle of it as it's flying towards the center of the sun, and he is bathed in his bomb. He is one with his bomb. And then, I don't know if they show it on screen, but 8 minutes later, they cut to the planet Earth, the only time you see the Earth in the film, and you see two children playing in the snow, and a woman watching a video from Capa where he says, okay, sis, if it's a particularly beautiful day, you know, you'll know we've succeeded. And she puts down her phone, she calls her kids over, and you see this Arctic tundra landscape. You think you're in Alaska or, I don't know, Wisconsin or Siberia or something.
Siberia, yeah, you're pretty close.
You see the sun rising. It's the Sydney Opera House. So they kind of do this cute thing where they're like, okay, this is how bad it was, you know, literally like Sydney is a tundra, but now the sun is bright and it's a good day, so they've succeeded, and that's everyone dies on the ship, but maybe the people on Earth survived.
Yeah,
we actually don't know. I mean, we don't know if they succeed. We know it was a nice day.
Yeah, it's kind of funny to me because one of the thoughts I had at the end of the movie, once it was realized that it was in Australia, I kind of almost thought it was a bit like a reverse version of On the Beach, that classic movie, classic book, where a lot of the characters are essentially waiting at the end of a nuclear war, global nuclear war that took place. The people in Australia are waiting as the last country that will receive fallout, a big cloud of radioactive fallout that's basically going to kill everybody, and they're all dealing with that reality in their life, counting down the minutes. This is kind of like a reverse version of that. Instead of a nuclear war, nuclear device that is destroying the Earth, and people in Australia are waiting on the beach for it to land, it's them in the Sydney area waiting for the warm sun and a nuclear stellar bomb saving the day. So kind of a fun little reverse there. Not sure it's intentional, but that's how my brain works. So that was great. So we covered two movies in about 2 hours. We've got some nuclear content to cover before we get into our non-nuclear discussion stuff, because I think we've got a lot of fun stuff to wrap up here. So I've got those two questions from earlier that I think we should kind of cover a little bit, knowing that we went long here, but you know, these are fun movies to talk about. And
It's a double episode.
It's a double whammy. It's your first episode. We're going to do great. And also, I haven't did a podcast in 3 months, so people deserve more content. How did each movie show off the savior power of the bomb? Because both of these take nuclear weapons as this kind of central positive force in order to be able to save the world. You know, the core, from my perspective, really dives into this theme head on with that kind of bit of dialogue we talked about earlier. With luck, irony will break for the good guys. For once, the world's biggest weapons of mass destruction will save the world. Sunshine really doesn't get into that particular aspect, except, you know, the world is in a scenario, you know, has no nuclear weapons left. So that's probably a positive development, at least. Unless, of course, the Russians hid one of those bombs that you said they wouldn't know if they went missing. You know, it is an interesting item here about kind of the way these two nuclear films or films with nuclear plots kind of go into that perspective. As someone, as yourself, who's into international security, but nuclear weapons aren't the main thing that you kind of studied, what was your take from that? Does it come across to you that, like, an Armageddon situation where, like, yeah, these are dangerous, but these are going to save the day?
Well, I'll tell you what they do independently. I think the Corps is more, shockingly, the Corps is, like, more aware and actively addresses that, basically through the one line, the irony line. Mm-hmm. And I think that's because these are very different movies in terms of, like, the Corps is like a, I don't want to call it a B movie, but it's like a action flick, a disaster flick, definitely more in line with, like, you know, Armageddon, Deep Impact, Meteor, these kind of movies that we've talked about before and you talked about in the pod. I feel like they need to put that line in there because kind of going just for your general audience, and they kind of have to put that in there. Sunshine is kind of like an art house picture in a lot of ways. Like, it's a $40 million movie. Like, don't get me wrong, it's not a cheap film. It's a big movie. Or it was a big movie. I almost feel like they didn't have to do that because the people, like the audience for that film, is not the same as the core audience. If we're talking about, like, your
broad, yeah, no, that makes perfect sense.
A release, you know, maybe the people watching the Sunshine are like, you know, yeah, we know that these things are not good. It's also different in the way they're framing it in a lot of ways, because in the core, they're, like you said, they're loading 200 megaton, which don't exist, 200 megaton weapons onto this train drill that they've made. In Sunshine, it's not like, I mean, they call it a bomb, but it's not like they're taking, it's a new thing. It's like a new piece of technology that they've arrayed from all the fissile material on Earth. It's not like they've taken, you know, a bunch of warheads and strapped them to the front of the spaceship. They've kind of created a more elegant thing, I guess, which has one purpose. Like, it's a purpose specifically designed piece of equipment, piece of technology. So I guess, but Sunshine doesn't really, I mean, I think both of these films drive at this thing in our psyche, which I was thinking about earlier today, which is like, I think we still think of these weapons even post-Cold War, and like, we're not kids of the Cold War. We're obviously like millennial people who grew up in a largely a world without this framing, like our every day.
Speak for yourself. I have think about it every single darn day. But I
well, that's your job.
I agree, because like... because I'm weird. I completely agree with you, though. Kidding.
But I think we view these weapons as like the peak technological achievement of humanity.
Mm-hmm.
Even though, like, despite how destructive they are, despite how very readily they could kill everyone on Earth, we still think they're like pretty impressive. I think our fiction reflects that, because we want, I think we use our fiction to find an outlet for that view, for that belief, because reality does not reflect that belief. So we have to use our fiction to reflect that for us. Maybe that's a bit too high.
No, I think that's cool. I think that's really cool. Another perspective on it. And I don't, you know, for me, I'm just kind of thinking through different thoughts that like kind of similar to what you're doing. Another angle that I was thinking with this is there's some small element of man bites dog situation. Like, it's abnormal that these weapons are positive and helping us.
Right.
From a moviegoer, from the core, it's like, oh, that's kind of interesting. You're right. These things, which I've been known to be dangerous and be, you know, lethal, duck and cover drills, hide because your phone accidentally tells you that there is an incoming missile into Hawaii, so hide. So, like, the worry, now they're on our side. It's, like, basically that Godzilla versus... Right. Anybody, it's like, well, now he's on my side. And it's that there's that element of weirdness that kind of tweaks this a little bit and gives you that sense of this is kind of a fun, different action take on it. But I also do think the movies could conceivably not make it about nuclear weapons at all, because in the core, they could have just invented some other kind of thing. It didn't have to be a nuclear weapon that would restart the Earth's core spinning. It could have been something else. You know, they went with big explosive, this is the most powerful punch we can throw kind of approach. But they also just were like, oh, yeah, there's a train. It's made of a magic metal. Also, it can have a magic laser in the front of it and all of these other components of like special radios that can reach from the core to the Project Destiny, which can cause earthquakes around the world and not be detected. They make up a bunch of essentially science stuff anyways, and could have simply invented the unobtainium bomb, and it would have been some other kind of thing, but they grounded it in something people know. And I think Sunshine is really fascinating to me, because they kind of did it, even though it's not in your face all the time. Murphy's not going around, Kappa's not going around saying, this is like a fission bomb with unearthed. And but they'd say, they take all the fissile material, build a nuclear weapon, but they add dark matter to it. It's just funny to me that they didn't just create something whole cloth, something new. They took some, not fake science, but not any science that we understand today about how to harness and produce that much dark matter. But they took that, tied it to something that we did know, and made a different thing. And it was funny that they went that direction versus just entirely creating something out of whole cloth. I find that interesting, that they could have gone one way or the other, but still feel the need, even in this very interesting science of the future kind of direction, they still had to ground it.
Maybe that's a strength of the movies and also a flaw. Like, as a movie-going audience, people watch these things, we want a little bit of grit and reality in the solution, right? We don't want it to be like a Deus Ex Machina thing where there's like a magical thing that just like fits. Like, to your point, like, I could think of, because I was thinking today, like, when you brought this up in the show notes, spoiler alert for the audience, this is not all extemporaneous. I thought it was before I became a host. No, when you brought that up in the show
it's all AI written these days.
Yeah, that's right. No one knows what's actually Icarus wrote this, the computer from such a, but she forgot to redirect the shields. No, I was thinking that, like, what could be in Sunshine if it wasn't a warhead or whatever, a payload, what could it be? And I was thinking, well, maybe we isolated like a single particle from the Big Bang, and we can, like, because we have that particle, we can use that to, like, recreate, I don't know.
Higgs boson or whatever, right?
Yeah, right. There actually is science behind that, right? Like, you know, you could, like, make some stuff up that would kind of be sciencey enough to sound good.
We have to sprinkle this magic dust on the sun, and it will spice it up a bit.
Yeah, but, like, to go back to your point, and to go back to your original point, like, why? I think it's because we love these things. We're impressed by them. We're intimidated by them. We're in awe of them. And we want to see them portrayed on film, and we want to see what we perceive is to be like a brilliant level of human achievement and engineering, like doing good things versus bad things.
It's funny. That's the weird, ironic kind of long take in Dr. Strangelove's title, which is Dr. Strangelove, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Bomb. I mean, Capa fully is, you know, not worrying anymore about surviving, and he's loving his stellar bomb.
Yeah.
But now I come to the point of like, all right, if you're going to ground this thing in reality, all right, well, in the reality, will these weapons do anything to solve these problems? Like, you're bringing this solution to this problem that you've created. You know, you're the screenwriters for it. Will these actually work? So with the core, on a study that I found on this website called Intuitor, you know, looks at the movie's physics of the core and says, you know, look, the solid iron inner core of the Earth has a rotational kinetic energy equivalent to about 350 200 megaton bombs, consistently always happening. That's the amount of energy that this thing is having when it rotates. The liquid metal, primarily iron, outer core surrounding the inner core has a normal rotational kinetic equivalent to roughly 32,200 megaton bombs. They bring 5. Assuming that the inner core has to be restarted and that all of the bomb's energy can be converted to rotational energy, they would need at least 335 of those bombs, more than they already brought on the ship. So it's basically a speck in the wind trying to stop a hurricane from approaching.
We're going to need a bigger boat.
And they tried to make a bigger bomb by putting plutonium next to another one. It also does not make sense from this other perspective, which I didn't pick up until I had a weird random thought in the middle of a work meeting today. And I was like, sorry, I have to write this down. If a bomb explodes, and this is, again, tying back to how nuclear weapons, when you're a warfighter and planner and whatever, and you're trying to figure out where to put your bomb exploding, they explode in a circle because it's a bomb that's not shaped to explode in a certain direction. It's not a laser. It blows up in a circle. It kind of just explodes from its center. If you put a bomb like that inside the Earth's core, it doesn't push anything in one direction or another because it's literally surrounded by the core. So how do you force the core to spin in one direction when basically the force that you're applying to it is everywhere extending from the point of the explosion taking place? And yeah, that was their original plan, and eventually they daisy chain the bombs, but still, that none of those things are going in a direction. It's equal direction the other way, too. Firmly does not make any sense about what they're trying to do with this.
They try to explain it through the pond ripples thing, like...
No.
But it's like... it's like ripples in a pond, where the ripples reinforce each other if you, like, throw a bunch of small stones in versus one big stone. I'm like, yeah, but when I throw a bunch of stones in the pond, I don't create a whirlpool.
Right. Exactly. You know, it's not just like this, the Earth's core isn't sleepy and we need to shake it awake. Like, we're trying to get it spinning in a direct, whatever. And then, you know, you look at the, you know, you try to approach a little bit of the sun, and the amount of energy you would need to restart the sun is also pretty wild when you're trying to calculate those kinds of stuff. Essentially, the sun, for scaling purposes, literally has flares that fly out from it that are 10 times the size of Earth. And you start to factor in all of the fissile material on Earth. You start to get the sense of the scale. And also, fissile material is like less than 1% of all of the material on Earth is anywhere. It's way lower than that, even the amount of uranium that you could mine off of the Earth. It's not like just rock or iron. Essentially, the amount of nuclear bombs that you would have to need to basically have any sort of impact on that is truly, truly astronomical.
No pun intended.
Yeah. The sun has the equivalent of, like, energy or force of essentially 4 billion hydrogen bombs going off every single second. And if you want a new heat source to restart the fusion reaction, that would not, you know, in the center of the Earth, the amount would have to be crazy. Now, the movie says, you know, Brian Cox, who is the, we mentioned earlier, the physicist who was helping with this, posits this idea that there's this thing called a cue ball, which is like a highly dense, packed, highly energetic object that may have been around during the original Big Bang, has gotten caught in the sun's gravitational and is stopping the reactions from happening. I guess the idea in the movie is that it goes to that cue ball and explodes it and disrupts it, disperses it, so that no longer is there something drawing and stopping the fusion reaction of the sun. I don't think that comes across super, super great in the movie. It seems like it's more like the sun's slowing down. They want to reignite it. Look, either way, the amount of fissile material that we have on Earth would have to be really supplemented by this dark matter stuff. So it really is pointless to talk about from the perspective of the science behind it, other than just to say it'd have to be super magic to have any sort of impact on the intensity relative to make any sort of difference of what the sun is producing on a regular basis.
I mean, imagine you had a really big bonfire that was kind of burning down and you like flicked a match into it. That's kind of like how I think it would actually go.
100%. And then also the movie ignores the fact that there's like, if you think about when a star dies, it gets hotter before it gets colder. It burns hotter and then gets colder. It doesn't just like slowly get cold. But then of course, then you don't have a movie, right? It's fine. I think this is not important to what the movie is trying to do. Oddly enough, the B movie is trying to ground stuff more than the high concept picture, but I think you nailed it. Like, there are different audiences, there are different attempts for the film. People are coming in with different expectations, and they're trying to accomplish different things.
Yeah, I think so. I think that's kind of the key here. They're also 3 years apart or 4 years apart, but they feel like they're from vastly different eras of cinema. Like 2003, The Core feels like one of those movies from 20 years ago that was so much.
Yep.
A disaster driven, there's a love interest hidden in there. There's like,
it feels like the movie Meteor, which I don't know if you've ever seen, but that's, add that to your list. It's a Sean Connery.
I actually haven't seen Meteor. Okay. Yeah.
It's a Sean Connery, like nuke meteors kind of stuff, but it feels very similar to it.
It feels like a 1996, it feels like Independence Day, it feels like Armageddon, it feels like Twister almost, like kind of the just your classic kind of disaster picture. Whereas Sunshine feels like it was like 20 years too early.
Yeah.
I mean, that movie feels like it come out today, and with some minor tweaks, I think it would be like really good and really well appreciated amongst an audience today. But maybe a few choices made differently. But I think that was a film a little bit ahead of its time. But
there's other stuff I was going to talk about here, where there's some interesting uses of nuclear weapons in the history of us in the atomic age. Where,
oh yeah, let me back my segue back up.
Yeah,
from the parking lot into the,
just super quick, peaceful nuclear blast, which is a funny name in itself. But there were these science experiments and actual application of nuclear weapons in construction projects and in stopping various kinds of disaster situations that the Soviet Union did. So one example is in September 1966, a 30 kiloton nuclear device, so very, very small compared to like a 200 megaton bomb, but you know, larger than the bombs that were dropped on Japan. This was used by the Soviet Union to extinguish a fire that was out of control for 3 years at a natural gas field in Central Asia. They dropped this explosive device essentially about 1,500 meters down, so not at the Earth's core, but you know, deep enough, loaded it, and the idea there is that it would basically both kind of suck away any sort of oxygen that was fueling or any sort of source of fuel, but also cause collapses from the Earth's source of that fuel and essentially collapse all those tunnels. And it worked. They did it, you know, twice in 1972. They especially designed the charge to its best ability to focus on one location and not just create a big hole like you would if you were testing a nuclear bomb that would create a hole that then the Earth above it would fall down, and that's when you get those kind of crater-looking subsidence craters. But anyways, I'll link to some stories from the New York Times about it, so we don't have to get into it too much. We talked about it in previous episodes, but there is a lot of application of trying to use nuclear weapons in the past for these quote-unquote peaceful projects. U.S. had a whole version of this stuff called the Plowshares Program in various nuclear construction project testing. Let's move from the nuke discussions to our parking lot, which is where we would talk about non-nuclear things. It's kind of reminiscent of what you and I did last Thursday, where we went to a movie and talked about it a little bit in the parking lot before we went our separate ways. It's what I used to do a lot when I was a kid.
Yeah.
So, first, how important is science accuracy in these kinds of movies? We alluded to this earlier. Dustin Hoffman, man, did not like The Core. He became the face of a lobby group called the Science and Entertainment Exchange, where the whole point of this program was to work with the National Academy of Sciences and promote films that they thought respected scientific principles, like Jurassic Park, which, don't get me wrong into that, like, also is pretty crazy when it comes to DNA, but they thought it was good.
Yeah.
And then debunk movies like The Core, which Dustin thinks, quote-unquote, you can make entertaining movies which also get a message across about without slowing down the action, a source said. He hated these big blockbusters. Why can't we do it better? And then they quoted a poll of hundreds of scientists who were asked what was the worst sci-fi movie with science in it. And they said The Core was at the top of the list.
Yeah, I can see that being true. I'll push back a little bit, and I'll just say that, like, The Core does explain to people that there is a core to the Earth. And that it rotates, and that helps with the electromagnetic, or creates the electromagnetic magnetic field. Now, as you mentioned, they do get that wrong in terms of the effects of not having one. But it does correctly explain that there is one, and that the core of the Earth has something to do with it. So I think that's in the plus column. There is a lot in the minus column for the film.
It's like that the more you know thing where you have that star fly across the sky.
Right.
But instead of a star, it's like a piece of space junk. So it's visually the same, but, you know, not exactly the same bright idea.
I would say to Dustin Hoffman, don't let the perfect be the enemy of the good.
Fair enough. I wish we'll get him on as a guest sometime.
Did we try to get him on? We tried to get him on this one, I think, but he was busy, I think, for this one.
Danny Boyle tried, the director of Sunshine, to ground his crew a little bit in more of science. You know, he did try to reach out to Brian Cox, that physicist, and say, make this idea work. What would it take to make the sun go cold? And they tried their best with this cue ball space matter theory, trying to do all that kind of stuff. Danny Boyle brought his crew onto a nuclear submarine and give them a sense of what life was like there in terms of the isolation and dealing with these kinds of potential world-ending scenarios. I actually kind of thought it was interesting that they were the ones on Sunshine that got taken to a nuclear submarine, because throughout the entirety of The Core, all I was thinking was, this is like a submarine movie, weirdly enough. They're not in water, yeah. But the way that the ship works, the way that the train works. And Danny Boyle did say, like, well, the movie, like, the science isn't perfect. The way he characterized it is, it's a case of science possible, not science impossible. So they're trying to walk that line.
Yeah.
UCLA physicist Alexander Kushenko was asked, essentially, if their son was dying, how would you restart it? Which they thought will happen in 5 billion years. He's like, I don't know. I don't really have any good ideas, but nuclear bombs don't seem to be like a feasible option. But of course, it's not just a nuclear bomb. It's a stellar bomb, right?
Yeah.
Very, very different. But yeah, and even Brian Cox was saying, like, yeah, you know, the movie, its science is a little shortcoming, but, like, what does he say? He says it shouldn't detract from the ability of the movie to raise vital questions about the universe's confounding and dangerous nature. Quote, what is certainly true is that our position on the fragile Earth is far from secure. We live in a violent universe that we certainly do not fully understand, which I also think, you know, end quote here, does mean this is not how very far from how people talk about nuclear weapons in human life. So fair enough.
Yeah, I think it is an interesting corollary to the discussion about the existence and creation of nuclear weapons. I think that I was thinking today whether the Sunshine is, you know, when we think about sort of the greatest existential threat to everyone, which is like global climate change and things like that. And Sunshine takes a different approach on that issue. Mm-hmm. Like, I think it's relevant given, like, you know, this movie just came out last week, like How to Blow Up a Pipeline. There are like more radical films that are coming out about sort of like how to approach climate change and to understand it. And I think like a younger generation is like going to be more engaged on those sort of movies. And this movie is like, well, no, the opposite's happening, actually. So I don't think the film is doing that deliberately. Like, this is not a film making a political point. I don't think at all. But it is interesting to like view it in a 2023 context, mostly through the lens of like, how do we view our ability to use technology to solve problems? Are we truly like technocrats as in like Western society? Like, do we think we have the power to solve these issues? Because I think our fiction, like I was saying earlier, like our fiction reflects our ambitions sometimes, how we want to see ourselves and what our technology can do. So I think it's actually interesting that like the basis for the question to begin with, and I think Brian Cox guessed at that, like, he's like, I have no idea how this would be solved, because there really isn't a solution. This would be, there is no solution to your star dying.
You would solve it the way that Josh Key does, which is you go to the bar and sit with your French friend and reminisce.
That's the most realistic scene in either of these films.
The Core, you know, at its core is an action movie. It's trying to present a fun environment, but still trying to, you know, touch on some of these kind of science stuff. But it, even the message that it kind of it has, it kind of sneakily is humans created this problem. We think we can solve it. I think the weird thing to me is someone who comes with that weird slant of like nuclear weapons are bad. And yeah, I guess they are the most destructive thing. So if you have to throw something at an asteroid, sure, seems like not the reason to invent them. But if you have them, maybe you keep one or two. But in this movie, it's like humans created this problem. The military did it. Maybe they slightly regret it, but yeah, really not much. The weird nature of mutually assured destruction and the drive to have the bigger bomb or having a bomb to match someone else ultimately resulted in them testing a device, Project Destiny, that caused the Earth to almost be destroyed. Well, what did we do? Where do we turn to for help? I mean, the next worst thing that has threatened humanity. But now this one works. So I don't know. It doesn't, I'm sure it's not their intention, but as someone like me watching that movie, again, with my political and military leanings here, it's very much like, oh yeah, thank you for recognizing that sometimes things can go wrong, but now you're just using this other solution that also is pretty bad too, and justifies its existence. And in Sunshine, at least they don't try to dig into that too much, and they kind of invent their own thing, but they are playing with what can be the scenarios where humanity is destroyed. We'll do our best. And I think what you said earlier is very, very, very relevant here. This is the pinnacle of humanity's scientific excellence. It is literally, when you have things these days, you either call something a moonshot when you're trying to advance technology quickly, a cancer moonshot, we need a moonshot for this, or we call it a Manhattan Project. A Manhattan Project for this. Because those are those moments where we recognize we tried, we accomplished something, we succeeded. At Sunshine, they create a Manhattan-sized weapon, drawing on imagery of this moment you talked about earlier, of like a cool development in human history, but to try to solve stuff through science. And there's that deleted scene that you sent me where Pinnebacker and Capa are talking, and it's like, you not know God? Pinnebacker says, and what does Capa say? Like, I don't believe in God. I'm atheist.
I'm an atheist, yeah.
But I made this thing, and boom.
Yeah.
Last question I have here in our parking lot before we need to wrap this up, because I'm looking at how I'm going to have to edit this all together, but...
I apologize. This is going to be a tough edit, I apologize.
No, that's fine. I haven't edited in a while, so I'm going to get my juices going again. This is punishment for me and penance for how long we've taken to have another episode come out. The last question, but I do want to talk about this, is, did you, James, enjoy the thriller horror third act story in Sunshine? And relatedly, the military cover-up story of the core, both of the kind of like B-ish subplots of these movies.
Yeah, I'm gonna first in the core, I think that it's okay. Again, I think it's not okay, it's bad, but like what we were talking about earlier, like, did they have some kind of consultant in the writer's room who was perhaps advising them on how these things work? Maybe they had someone like you who they ignored, who the studio put in there. They just said, sit in the corner, consultant boy, and you'll be summoned if you're needed. And that never happened. There is I think it's particularly interesting this week with all these leaks from the Air Force Base in Massachusetts, and there is a very lax patrol on classified information.
Zeminski just brings it home and puts it next to his cigarette humidor.
Their solution in the movie seems to be, well, we'll just scrub the internet. And that's sort of it. No one who's working on this project seems to be like quarantined or sequestered or anything like that. Everyone is
there's just not sort of... a Manhattan Project, of which also equals the secrecy of the bomb project.
No, they seemed like they're free to go. I would also like to acknowledge the very French thing in this film, where they drink a bottle of champagne before they go. I mean, granted, there's like six of them, and it's probably not that much champagne. None of them are drunk, but it's still just like, you know, it's...
yeah.
Let's drink this bottle of champagne before we get on this.
Yeah, it's, exactly. It's like before they get a space shuttle in like Apollo 13. Like, we're going to light this candle. But before we do, it's good the candle's lit, because let's open up the bottle of champagne. It's a nice romantic moment.
Yeah, it's a nice moment. I like it on screen. I like that, you know, the French guy's like, oh, I could not resist. And he just like pulls out a bottle of champagne out of his
coat. It just would have been great too if like Keys came out, it's like, I can't resist either. The American just pulls out a gun and starts firing in the air.
Yeah. But I think, yeah, it is pretty weak. And I think they try to like round off the very morally dubious, like scrubbing the internet question at the end, where they like release everything to the public.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's kind of like a weird way to do that, because you're kind of saying like, we need to keep all this information for everybody, but then like we're equipped to make the, you know, we're equipped to make the decision about when people have this stuff. And it's like, I don't want to call it like a libertarian take, but like, we know best, the scientists know best, the experts know best. It's sort of a strange thing. The whole thing, keeping it a secret from the public, is like a weird thing too, because it's like very incremental and it's happening very slowly. And like, you could just tell people, it just seems like a strange thing that they would keep covert. It's a weird plot beat in the movie. And I think like, there's plenty of disaster movies where people know what's going on and there's like some panic. And
yeah, you can wave it. You mean like Armageddon, basically. You think about the time place, the time period of the movie. So 2003, the Iraq War was happening, but there's no way they could have tied that much to it at that particular period, because the movie came out in 2003. You know, but it's post 9/11, there's Patriot Act stuff going on, a sense that the military is a place you could start to poke fun of. For a while after, though, 2003, you really couldn't. And I kind of was surprised after 9/11, being able to go after the military and refer to them basically as anything less than heroic is a bit of a surprise to me, even in a B movie. Like, the military does not come across well in the Corps. It comes across as people who made a mistake. There's no military official on the ship.
Well, she's I guess she's Air Force.
Fair enough. I associated her with more with the space program, but you're right. That is
Early Swank is technically Air Force. I guess she's detailed to NASA, but she's
we've trashed the Corps enough. What about Sunshine? Because to me, the final act of Sunshine is where it started to lose me. What about you? This kind of horror element that gets introduced.
Yeah, I think it's definitely a shock the first time you see it. I think upon a rewatch today, I was like noticing things that made it a bit more satisfying. Like. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's late in the film, but I talked about it earlier when, like, you see that the scalpels are missing from the drawer. You're like, okay, this is something's going to happen. When you see that first video of the captain, you kind of focus on that a bit more. I think the third act of this film really benefits from a rewatch. If you're going into this clean, like, if you were one of the 14 people who saw this in a theater in 2003, you'd probably be a little thrown off, but, like, now that I've watched it fourth or fifth time, I kind of expect those moments, and I'm kind of looking for little bits that help me understand that. With that said, I think it's not great, but I've racked my brain today trying to think of like something else they could have put in there to fill that gap, because mm-hmm. it's like, because the movie is great. It leads up to this point. They get to the Icarus One, they dock, they go through the whole thing. They find the dead crew. They have the docking incident. All this stuff happens. But then it's like, maybe 30 minutes of movie, 20 minutes of movie that you have to fill, because you're only like an hour of movie at that point. I mean, this movie's lean. It's really a lean film. You know how it's going to end, and I think the ending is perfect. I like, it's not even the whole third act, because I think the ending with him and the payload and like the kind of beautiful romantic way they visualize that is, or they shoot that is great. So it's like, it's really just like 20 minutes of film, and I don't know what you would do. Like, I mean, I'm not obviously not a professional in this stuff, but what else could you put in there? Is it mm-hmm. like, because what I'm thinking is, okay, it's another technical problem, but space movies and sci-fi movies are, it's always just a technical problem. And it's like, this movie has so many technical problems that they solve to begin with. It would just seem like another one or another one, another one. I like that it's not a technical problem. Someone is trying to stab you. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of a different take on how this movie's going. I like how they shift gears.
Yeah, it's not The Martian.
I know that's a take that not everyone is going to like or agree with, but I've come to love the third act.
Okay.
I've come to appreciate the third act, because I don't know what else they could have done other than like have a sun god appear.
did we watch all the deleted scenes here? Like, it would just be really funny if the bomb goes off and the sun god like turns around and goes, ow! All right, so let's take this home, because this is we're back to the long episodes. I love it. Hopefully people that enjoy that will get a kick out of it. Let's do our rating system. This is where we rate the movies out of 5, and with James being all over Letterboxd, I get a lot of used to, you know, rating things out of 5, right? But here's how we do it. We don't just do stars. We tailor that rating system based on the plot that we just watched for these films. So let's rate The Corps and Sunshine with a scale of 1 out of 5 helpful nukes. One helpful nuke might get you out of a jam if your favorite flame is burning low, but 5 helpful nukes is probably, you know, really no different than a Manhattan-sized amount, so it really will light up your day. You want to have 5 as backups anyways. Let's start with The core. I give The core 2.5. It's not a great movie, but it's a movie that I enjoyed many elements of. That I was, you know, I was slightly exaggerating some of my rant stuff, but the nuke side of things was really annoying to me. But overall, I kind of enjoyed it. Even though I didn't understand some of the stuff, it was fine. But it will never inch more than 2.5. But for a disaster B-movie, that's fine. Right in the middle here. 3 is average. This is slightly below average. But for this kind of thing, 2.5 is the way to go.
Yeah, Tim, I agree. I think 2.5 seems fair. It has a lot of cool moments. I love Aaron Eckhart. I love the whole idea of the ship. I love the concept. A lot of cool, like, fake science elements that are awesome, like, that really scratch itch for me. Where it falters, I think, is generally the entire premise. The CGI is pretty bad.
This is where you pull off your face mask and you're Dustin Hoffman.
Yeah, I mean, I don't particularly care about the science elements. It's a film. It's fiction. Like, that's good. I just think, like, there's a lot of plot holes here that they could shoot a big laser into, which they do, or they try to. And it sort of is guilty of, like, some of the worst movie tropes, I think, in late 90s, early 2000s cinema. So I think 2.5 is good. I've watched it twice, enjoyed it twice, but it is, I think, your quintessential popcorn movie.
Sunshine, which is what you would apply to popcorn to make it pop. So I would give this a 3. On first viewing, I don't disagree, and I think this will improve, in my view, upon a second watch, which I will do this weekend. Just for me, I love the visuals and the tone of the movie. I started watching this movie fairly late in the evening after I put my kid to sleep, and I was going to pause it and then resume it the next day, but it drew me in so much that I just kept watching it. And I didn't go to bed until like 1:30 or something. To me, that's very late. I'm almost 40. It was very cool. I love the psychological part at the beginning. But once it became a thriller, horror, somewhat a killer on the loose, it was such a surprise. I didn't know anything about this. It was the first time I saw the movie. It threw me off so much. And it really made me like, oh, this is where we're landing on this? And I didn't really appreciate what it was trying to do in terms of the religious allegories and that kind of other piece to it until really more reading it later, talking to you now. I think I can raise this movie up to a 4, and I want it to because I like the idea of this. I just can't tell you when I first watched it really what that message was. It may have been just simply because I was too thrown off by what was happening with where they ultimately went with the direction with Pinat Becker. This is one of the ratings I'm the most conflicted over, and I think it will change, but I have to be honest about what my first reaction to it was. But I see here in the notes you have a different take.
Yeah, no, I'm gonna rate this movie a 4.9 on the sunshield percentage. sorry to deviate from your scale, but I know that'll kill me. I love this movie. I think it's almost perfect, and it's probably firmly in my top 5 favorite movies of all time. It might be my favorite movie.
Wow.
And I know that's a bold statement, but it's just how I feel about it. It makes me feel awesome, and I love watching it. The thriller portions are kind of a miss, but I've kind of come to respect them as an exciting way to frame the third act. I think in a more conventional sci-fi disaster movie, you'd have some technical problem they have to overcome. But this movie has a lot of technical problems. They have to solve all those things already. So it's, I think, having these kind of like this thriller or like interpersonal issues and drama, I think is kind of a nice way to overcome that problem. And it's like they're 93 million miles from Earth, but they still have to deal with a killer, I think is like kind of a cool idea. So yeah, I love the film. I love Cillian Murphy. I love Danny Boyle. One thing we didn't talk about this movie at all in this episode, I just have to mention it now because I will get another opportunity to, is the score is fantastic.
Amazing.
The score is one of the most like enveloping, amazing scores I've ever seen in film. And I'm going to reference something when we go to our recommended stuff, but they use the score in other movies. This movie was such a flop. They've licensed this amazing score to be used in other films. So it's like, it's just a beautiful score, and it totally makes the movie, the use of the score. Tim, yeah. I don't know if you have anything to say about that.
I don't disagree with most of that. I think this will improve for me. I don't think it will ever get to a almost 5 perfect movie, but I want to give it another shot, and I'm looking forward to rewatching it over the weekend with a kind of a fresh eye, knowing what the twist is, and just letting more of the themes roll over me versus the, what? This is what we're doing? Okay. I thought we were doing something else. Some stuff that we'll recommend to listeners to either read or watch later, somewhat related to the things things we talked about today, or maybe something in the genre. I've got a handful of stuff I want to recommend, and I think you do too, probably from your long catalog of movies and things you purchased or watched recently. Maybe I recommend a movie I might have mentioned before, but I love this film. It's called Aniara, A-N-I-A-R-A. It's 2018 Swedish movie. It's also based on a long, like, epic poem. It's about a spaceship. It's a resort ship. It's on its way after the Earth has been ravaged by climate change. Everybody's slowly leaving and going to Mars, where they can live there instead. This ship has all the creature comforts that we see on the Icarus 1 and 2, including, like, the Earth Room type thing of, like, a virtual reality, think of Earth, calm down kind of situation. But for something happens, the ship gets off course, the power goes out, and they don't have power anymore, and it's just slowly drifting off in the direction that it was going. The crew and people essentially slowly go insane. And it takes place, you know, 1 year, 5, 10, 13, 20, and then all the way up to 5 million years later, what happens with this ship. And it is a really slow burn, very cool look at what people do when they go insane on these kinds of situations. Really strongly recommend it. Second, I recommend a book by David Kagan from 1993 called Sunstroke. Is about a space solar power system that would draw, it's a big solar power satellite in space, and then it generates electricity and zaps it down to a receiving station via microwaves as a constantly energizer bunny power source. It's an interesting take on real life science that people have been trying to build forever, but of course it freaks out and becomes more like a military weapon and starts melting various parts of the world. So it reminded me of that scene at the San Francisco. So if you want to see that visualized in your head, again, in narrative fiction, check out that book. I will also link to an article about in the New York Times from 1971 about those Soviet nuclear blasts that put out the fire in the oil fields. And finally, I recommend a book similar to Sunshine, where the first two-thirds of it are amazing to me, and the final third, I can take it or leave it, by Neal Stephenson, called Seven Eves, and is essentially about, for some reason, the moon explodes. Earth has to deal with that, and most of it is involving Earth trying to build a space shuttle and get as many people there as they can and try to keep humanity going, knowing that most people on Earth are going to die. It's a really fascinating book, and it just solves a lot of the similar technical component problems that they do in the core, but also touches a bit on psychological components that are in the more like fatalistic components that are in Sunshine. So Seven Eves, first two-thirds of that book are amazing. The final third, it's fine. It kind of didn't really end anywhere. James, you got three things to recommend?
I do, yeah. So the first recommendation is another podcast. I'm sorry.
Oh my gosh.
Tim, I know. There's a podcast which I think a lot of movie people will be familiar with, but the podcast is called Blank Check with Griffin and David. They did a Sunshine episode on March 19th. They really go into a lot more
of this year.
Of this year, yep. 2023, a couple weeks ago. They're really, because they're doing a whole Danny Boyle. They pick a director and they do every movie in his filmography. So they did Sunshine on March 19th. They go into a lot about the production of the film. Really good if you have an interest in how movies get made and why this one flopped. Also a lot of info. I cribbed a little bit of it for this one just as teasers, but a lot of good info about, you know, how they assembled the cast, most of this movie was like practical effects, which is kind of unheard of. The CGI in Sunshine, why it looks so good is because, and why it looks good for $40 million is because they just said, well, take as long as you like. Like, they didn't really have like a deadline, so they were kind of bottom of the priority list at the CGI houses, but as a result, they got really good stuff for very cheap. They just had to wait, which is a problem if you've seen any of the Marvel films of the last 5 years. Anyway, my next.
I mean, Chris Evans and Benedict Wong want to knock down your door, but fair enough.
That's true. Yeah. I mean, there's two Marvel stars in this movie. It's a crazy cast. But anyway, if you want more like the movie stuff, like the movie nerd stuff, listen to that episode. March 19th, Blank Check. Really good episode. The next one is a little Ad Astra, 2019, Brad Pitt. I think this movie and Sunshine are in like kind of the same universe of elevated sci-fi that's grounded, realistic, but that still has a lot of, it's still a lot of fun. I'd also say much earlier, it is a recommendation, but like Contact is kind of in the same realm. Interstellar to a certain extent, but like that's a little up its it's a little weird. Mm-hmm. But I think like Ad Astra, I think in this movie are really good like examples of how you make kind of a cool sci-fi movie, modern, that feels like not too distant from where we are, but also feels like it feels tangible to me. That's one of my favorite things about Sunshine, is that it feels tangible. Ad Astra also feels tangible, and it's like, I think that's what I like about both those films. So I recommend that. I'm sure everyone has seen it, but not really a blockbuster.
I haven't seen it yet. It's been on my, like, occasionally will be on, like, HBO Max, and I'll put it on the watch list, and it pops off. We'll have to make sure that goes up higher.
Yeah, it's really good. 2019, James Gray. Definitely watch it. And then just a Danny Boyle recommendation, 1996 Trainspotting, his second movie. It's about living in Scotland during the late 1980s and being addicted to heroin. And I think one of the best things about Danny Boyle, the director, is that he can really do anything. I mean, he made Trainspotting in 1996. He did 28 Days Later. So he did a kind of a local like drug drama comedy. Then he goes, he makes 28 Days Later, like a zombie movie. Then he goes and shoots Sunshine, a $40 million space movie. And then he goes and makes Slumdog Millionaire.
Yep.
And he wins an Oscar. So it's fun watching his filmography just because he can do so many things. And I think it's one of those things, he's like such an incredible artist and director, that if you can do things that are so different, I mean, it's just a master of the craft. He's one of my favorite directors. So I think watching his second film and his like kind of, it's not a weird film, but it's just like an awesome movie, and it's really quick. It's a 93 minute movie. So watch Trainspotting.
So many of Danny Boyle's movies involve someone, you know, hurting their arm or hand, like, you know, Trainspotting, injecting heroin into it. In this movie we watch Sunshine, poor Chris Evans' hand gets frozen, and you know, and then in 127 hours, it's all about sawing off your hand. And I'm pretty sure also at one point, too, they cut off someone's arm in, 28 Days Later or whatever.
I'm sure there's a zombie that loses an arm in that movie.
So, I don't know what this guy, you know, tickets cost an arm and a leg when you go see a Danny Boyle movie. James, thanks so much for talking to me today and coming on the podcast here. Anything you want to plug? Do you want to tell people where they can find your litterbox?
Yeah. So thanks, Tim. Happy to be on this sort of first episode as co-host. You can find me on Letterboxd. That's a social media like site for film nerds. You can find me on there at letterboxd.com, and then my name is Thok Thok on there. So that's Thokk, no spaces. So that's Thok Thok, Thokk. Thokk.
I follow it because I follow what movies you're watching in this like ambitious list. It's very entertaining, and you put your thoughts are really fun into it.
I appreciate that. Yeah, I put my thoughts up there. I don't do ratings. I don't rate anything. I just say if I like it or I don't like it, and then I put my thoughts. So that's up there. So yeah, that's the only thing I want to plug, I guess. Cool.
Well, you passed the test as co-host. We're definitely looking forward to our next. We have a lot of stuff to talk about. So again, thanks again.
I appreciate it. Now, I think the next one you said we were going to do Made in Manhattan because of the it's a Manhattan Project movie, right?
We just want to make sure.
We just want to make sure there's not a mention there, right?
We have to prep for the Manhattan Project movie that's coming out later.
So we have to watch everything that has the word Manhattan in it just to make sure they don't make reference, right?
And also have to watch the original live action Mario Brothers movies, because that one is Dino Hatton. So we're going to make sure maybe the dinosaurs invent something nuclear wise. We just want to make sure all of our bases are covered.
It just makes it's good sense.
Yep. Thanks for listening to another episode of the Supercritical Podcast. If you have any suggestions for future episodes or want to tell us what we got wrong, either nuke-wise or maybe I just didn't understand that it would be scary to have a man with no skin running after you with a magic scalpel. I get it. Now I get it. There are a couple ways you can contact the show. Twitter at Nuclear Podcast is where I tweet these days, thinking about deleting it because Twitter sucks, but it is one of the best ways I get to connect with people. I also have a website, supercriticalpodcast.com, and I am gonna get better, I promise, at responding to people's excellent messages on our email account, supercriticalpodcast@gmail.com. Until next time, this has been Tim Westmyer
and James Sheehan,
and remember, if it's pop culture and radioactive, it may take 4 months between episodes, but we're bound to get supercritical about it. Have a good one.
Cheers.